intercept, but don't shoot. Ever since the United States Air Force top brass issued this order in 1948, American pilots have been mockingly defied by the unidentified flying objects that frequently invade the airspace of the United States as though on peaceful missions of exploration. Why hasn't the Air Force authorized its pilots to shoot these mysterious invaders down? Fear of extraterrestrial reprisal? I don't think so. Diplomatic protests from the unknown power that possesses the biggest secret of our times? I don't think so. Technological awe dictated by ignorance? Again, I do not think so. Or finally, deliberate deceit dictated by circumstances? And I believe that that is the proper and final answer. I believe that when the United States Air Force issues a statement that they are not studying unidentified flying objects, they are telling the truth. I believe that when the United States Air Force issues a statement that unidentified flying objects do not represent a threat to the national security, they are telling the truth. And all the ufologists across the world claim, cover up, cover up. They're telling the truth. And they're not covering up anything, they're just not telling you that the technology belongs to us. At some future date, it will be used to promulgate the illusion of an extraterrestrial threat. At which time, the nations of the world will be made to get down on their knees and beg for the coming together under a one-world government for... Who speaks for planet Earth? Does anybody have an answer to that question? And in the face of such an external threat, would not all humanity realize that we are all the same? And would it not be in all of our interests to come together as one in order to face that threat? Now, lest you think I have gone batty, ladies and gentlemen, I have just quoted to you the exact words verbatim of Ronald Reagan during his presidency as he stood upon a stage with Mikhail Gorbachev, pledging that the military might of the Soviet Union and the United States of America would come together at some future date in the face of an extraterrestrial invasion to repel them from the Earth. Good night. And God bless you all.
Yo, 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 check this out. Go Deep episode 162 coming at you real quick. Me and my homeboy, Will the Actor Rowland, came in here today. We try to not tie up the Watchmen series, but this is a part four. The Watchmen series just seems like it's just ever evolving. This right here is a part four to the Watchmen series. Prettiest girl on the whole planet, other than my daughter Kimora, has just texted me. So that means I'm gonna have to text her back, which also means you guys have to go fuck off and listen to some music or something like that, because this is Go Deep episode 62. That's about it. I don't even have any Your Mama jokes today, so I'm gonna go jump in my DMs. You guys fuck off, listen to some music. After the music is going to be an interview. After that interview is going to be a documentary. Not a documentary, it's going to be like another little video. Alright, Go Deep 162. Tell your mother I love her, even though I'm cheating on her. Yeah, bitch!
Okay. The Jizza. Tony Touch Classic. You know what I'm saying? We're gonna bang y'all in the head one time, blaze up on y'all one time real fast.
Do the mix, you know on that saying? Shit. Make it a record real quick. Do your thing.
Seat belts on.
Yeah, hold up. All right, make it a record. Get down.
I take y'all niggas straight beneath the surface to the core. If it ain't raw, it's worthless. Pen tab professional, hole of ink. Wild river raps fall off the raft and sink. Tony let a brother touch, 20 bar rush. The way we push through equivalent, the rocket thrust. A large just, I lay it for the mixtapes. quick to Quaker label me. The sound came out of rusted crate, surrounded by cobwebs, beat smooth enough to slide through like bobsleds on a cold white snow, plus with the right flow. Wu-Tang niggas, they shine and make the mic glow.
You be killing all gorilla in with all that screw facing, pacing back and forth looking savage. Stop.
Whether plugged in or plugged out, iron gear mugged or thugged out, blooded or blood out, some was plugged out. Might look at you and slice you, buff in the face, stupid and save over Nike swoop. Who the fuck you think let y'all wild niggas in? Allow you to put down your guns and raise your pen. Rule a zigzag zig, we don't fuck with no pig. We teach the kids, you'd rather have a bullet or word to your wig. Motivates increases, pull a hole the size of 50 cent pieces. Don't worry about the weed or pussy, I read books. I'm liable to make your king with three rooks. You see the Wu devil, you raise the black fist. Maybe Tony touched Concord, needle will scratch this. The Ice Cube link you bought from the Jew for 80 G's was only appraised at 42. Gazed upon by the eyes of multitude of people who would trade gold for food. I heard boys had killed more than nuclear warhead. Was three sons who walk around dressed in all red. Bobby, did you say if you ever in Compton or Long Beach, break my son's Doc Doom in crisis with a nice piece.
Penetrate on mixtape with the legislation, illustrate constant elevation, spark friction, Shawshank, golden on redemption, endorsed by the master inscription signature.
Off top, mind orthodox style of attack, it's like Hannibal, rolling on elephant's back, pack a long barrel, busting off strong ammo, my light so vast, I cast 20 foot shadows, first family, fifth capo, micro to macro, load it in your head, play it back slow, act like you know, this is no drill. Murderous rap, but feel going for kill. On these New York City sidewalks, we walk camouflaged, dodging the eyes of the hawk. Can I sport, toting the fifth, sliding off? My live source moving across with brute force. Blood sport, many more heads face the blade. Fakers must fade, the stakes have now raised. Words of murder, suspense and intrigue make major league niggas show signs of fatigue. My killer bees span wider than seven seas. Squeeze on MCs with bullet train speed. Tony's touch create more gold than Midas. Your highness, all in your head like your hairstylist.
Frosty mug, big ringleaders, top secret thug. Lampin' and cheaters, Orenthal with the murder glove. Bone of the town, devilish grin, look peculiar. Swung on his faggot, knocked the windows out of Sylvia. Tim's got scuffed up, my ankles got sprained. That's my word, to every single seat I smack flames. Staten Island's Bayside, the teachings of Elijah. Thrown out the temple, now collided with the father. Nicknames Puddin', Clarence 13X before the Will Smiths and the limelights of Cuba Gooding. Lost in the cosmos, exploding through a quasar. Be ducking pulsars again and stay still, be the gods. Tony Touch, Tony Touch. Word out. Big face ghost in effect.
Look, these accounts, you know,
yeah.
half your followers are people that don't show their real names, so I don't know who they are.
Right.
Really.
Right.
And they're like, oh, this and this and this. And I said, look, you know, so and so said, can you unblock him? And I'm like, I will, but. Like, I don't want to be tagged in any fucking arguments. Right. I don't want to be like, look, so and so said this, he said that. I'm like, just piss off. I don't care anymore. I'm like,
right.
Too many people are arguing over a load of crap.
Right, definitely.
And it's like an end of guy who like, yes, he said he doesn't say crap, he says truth. I said, well, whatever it is, I don't want to be tagged into his truth because he just causes arguments. So hopefully a few of them have got the message now, because I just said I'll block permanently. I don't block people because I know most people's like hearts in the right place.
Right.
You know?
Right.
They want to help. Right. They want to do, they want to join in.
Right.
And I think a lot of them are, oh shit. I think a lot of them are very young.
Right. Right.
You know, for sure.
Definitely.
So yeah, I don't like, you know, some of these people I know, they've followed me for a long time and, you know, they have donated and joined in events and stuff, you know, so I don't want to like sink a strong word and a
right.
temporary might work,
right?
So
right.
We'll see, but it's just too much, mate, isn't it?
Yeah, way too much. That's ridiculous. Too much.
Every day it's like, come on,
right? I mean, I don't know, man. I don't think it's I don't think it's by accident, because even after this much calling out, you would think, God damn, change. But it's no, it's still full steam ahead.
Yeah, I just think, like, you know, I know that we've got our own group chat and a group of friends, but I don't like all this side taking.
Right.
You know, I don't like all this, like, where you have to, look, Will, look, this person done this.
Right.
Look, see, told you, right. Oh, wait.
Right.
Good.
Right.
And then the other person's like, oh, no, you're associated with them. And I'm like, I'm not associated with anybody, really. Yeah, but they follow you. Right.
Right.
It's like I said to you the other day, it's like a little bit of racism, isn't it? It's like assuming because someone follows me, I must be the same as them.
Definitely what it is.
Yeah, and that's what I'm saying. That's what I think. What's the word? Lost the plot, snapped a bit yesterday. You know, and a moan.
Huh?
At people, but you know, I'm not going to go into it. But the point being, it's just like I will tell anybody who I think might be being a dick to wind people up.
Right.
And I don't think anyone should wind anybody up.
Right, right. Right, 100%.
You've got something to say or you don't.
Right.
And that should be the bit, you know?
Right. And no sides. It's just right from wrong. It's really not taking sides. It's just right from wrong.
Yeah. I don't want to take sides. I don't want to be part of a team. I don't want to be part of a clique. I just want to be in the middle, you know, stick up for people that need sticking up for, like, genuinely.
Yep. I'll
fucking tell people who are being a dick that being a dick.
Too late now. You're already a watchman. Too late. Huh? I said too late now. You're already a watchman. It's too late.
We all are, though. That's the thing.
Huh?
Everybody is supposed to be.
Right, right, right. That's the thing. We're all watchmen.
Everybody's supposed to be a watchman.
Right, right.
Because we're watching out for the best interests of Zach.
Exactly. Exactly.
Is that not the thing? You know,
that's good that you...
Teams within teams.
Right.
Teams within teams and teams. And it's like, nah, man. Teams don't work if they got... The way I look at it, if you had a football team, or soccer, as you guys call it, you know, you can't have... It's 11 players. You can't have three groups of three and then one on his own.
Right.
They will never win a game.
Right.
So, as a movement, you can't have fucking teams.
Right.
If one of you's got something that you can say it to everybody.
Right.
Everybody should be equal. I've said this the last 3 years. I don't understand.
Right.
I don't understand. I don't get it.
I'm happy that you said that about the watchman supposed to be everybody, because that is, and we don't really talk about the watchman like that or what the plan was. We just came out and did it, but we did have a plan for it to be everybody included, not anybody excluded. So whoever wanted to be a watchman could be a watchman, you know?
If anything, it doesn't necessarily mean you're part of the team. It means it's like a symbolic thing to say.
Right.
Because obviously it's related to Zach the film, and obviously we're supposed to have the best interests of Zach and his family.
Right, right.
And, you know, we're supposed to look out for the likes of F. Johns and fucking, you know, the bloggers that want to, like, smear him and things, you know?
Right.
So,
right.
Yeah, we're supposed to be watching out. And equally, we should watch out for each other.
Right. Correct.
Mm-hmm.
Correct.
But no, that's what I'm saying. That's why I think, you know, I spoke to people on all sides and have said, look, I don't like all this stuff. I don't want to argue with anybody. Don't want to lose friends.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there are people on all sides that I've been friends with, and that's that. You know, I don't want to. It's just silly. It's pointless. Fucking let's tweet as much as we can.
Right.
You know, support each other, and try and get the outcome.
Right.
We're so close.
Right.
We're so close. That's the frustrating thing.
You're right.
But I think, do you know what? I'm sorry. Now I'm going on now. Got me on one now. I think I know what it is.
Tell me.
It's been so long. All right, it's been 3 years almost. But it feels like about 10 years, doesn't it, for everybody?
Yeah.
Everybody, and I mean everybody, has put in, like, everyone that's tweeted regularly or tweeted every now and then or checked on their timeline or looked in and watched videos and tried to keep up to date.
Right.
Everyone has invested so much of their own personal time and energy and money.
Right, exit.
And ordering things and saving up for things and to, but mostly everybody spent time. So I think it's so point to the end now where people are thinking, oh, for God's sake, can we just like know what's going on? I think people are getting so fed up
right.
with waiting
right.
that emotions now start to get really fucking like bubbling up.
Right.
And it's causing people to fucking clash.
Right, but at the same time, there's people actively waving that carrot in front of other people's face. So it's beginning to be just like a game, you know? It's, it's beginning to be stupid, dog. It's beginning to be like...
There's always been somebody or some people trying to up the other. Scoopers. But it's, you know, and that's just the battle we've had the whole time, but...
Yeah.
But it's just, you know... it's like we said months and months ago, if you've got some information that people want to know or should know or you think they should know, you say it. If not, that's it. Because, you know, look at the 40 Club.
Right.
In your face, but they did it deliberately just to wind people up.
Right.
You know?
I think it's the same shit going on, bro.
Maybe. I just don't want to fucking... It's, you know, everyone's, the problem is, everybody's had a say. This is from, like, outside looking in.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's had a say now.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's given their opinion.
Yep.
And now's the time to just shut up and move on.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, definitely.
Like, what is the point? If we all sit there and go, oh, yeah, they did this, and he said this, and she said that, and then tomorrow we go... say the exact same thing to each other, and the day after we say the same thing to each other, there's no point.
Right. No, I get it.
There has to be a line in the sand where everybody goes, fine, from now on, we just have to do the events. I speak to my friends, you speak to your friends, and leave each other alone.
Right.
And that's like, I've said that to some people, some of these people who I blocked, who have since asked not to be blocked.
Mm-hmm.
Like, fucking stop doing your memes. Yeah, but they've done this as well. And you're like, no. Everybody's had a say.
Right.
It's fucking stop now. Because it's making people, like me, other people, and people in general, just think, oh, fucking bollocks to this. I'm getting on with my own life.
Yeah.
And then our numbers are going to go down to nothing. And then, if the fucking Warner Brothers and Warner Media here realise that their demand's just lost interest... they might turn their back last minute on Zach.
But, yeah, you know what I mean? Yeah, I do feel you. I 100% feel you on that. I think, like you said, the frustration is mounting, but I don't know, man. I think there's people mounting the frustration, too. That's what I just kind of... You know what I mean? Like, I feel what you're saying, and I felt like that for a while, dog. And you know me. I sat on that shit for... a long time, you know, but it didn't stop. That's where we're at right now. It's like it is not stopping. Even if
it takes one side to stop reacting to the other.
Right.
And we and think, I know me, and maybe you.
Right.
And when I say we, I mean me as in everybody. It's everybody needs to start thinking that person's or these people or people are sharing these memes and tweets or deliberately fucking saying, look what they've done, you know,
right.
Or it's just go, all right, whatever, and just ignore it.
Right.
And ignore it.
Right.
So if there is a deliberate attempt by some people to cause people to argue or to reignite fucking old arguments, then just ignore.
Mm-hmm.
And we should only fucking... go for and like really fucking get in stuck into the bloggers that come out with these shitty fucking articles.
Right.
You know, the ones who lie, you know, the Andy Signor.
Right.
Oh, never want to work with Zach. Well, what a load of bollocks.
Right.
They're the people everybody has to go, fuck you.
Right.
And fucking put them right, you know?
Right.
We have to stop. So I know what you mean. You know, it does seem like there are people still that's still trying to fucking wind everybody up.
Right.
I think we have to be the ones to go, fine, whatever.
Yeah. No, definitely.
Not care anymore. Don't pay attention to it.
Right.
It's the only way people, because, like, I said before, so many people this last week or so inbox me. I'm like fucking, I feel like Oprah, you know? So people writing in for their issues for me to try and help. And I don't mind trying to help people, but it's just like, come on. And it's like, oh, I'm going to do this, and I've had enough, I'm going to leave, and before I leave, I'm going to say this to this person. And I'm like, no, don't do that. Just fucking chill. No point.
Right.
Relax, don't leave. You know, everybody needs you, and, you know, everyone's tweet matters, doesn't it?
Right.
So, it's fucking tiring, mate. It's got your own lives to deal with. You got own hobbies and interests to do. And want to help movement and get this film out and stuff. And
right.
The last thing everybody needs is it to be grief.
Right.
Isn't it? Do you know what I mean?
Right. Definitely.
Yeah, I was just pissed off yesterday, mate.
Yeah, I know.
Energy level was depleted, and I thought, you know what? I'll just let rip a little bit.
I know,
and I did feel bad afterwards. I did feel bad.
So why don't you text me back if you felt bad? Why don't you text me back?
Text you back when? I think I fell asleep.
Oh.
I woke up to loads of messages that were out of date.
Yeah.
But do you know when you just got a headache and you go, I'm going to bed? Yeah. Just lay there pissed off and it's tiring. It's tiring.
Yeah, no, it is.
Like messaging people and trying to like say, come on, like fucking, I'm not interested, I don't care. Or why are you doing this?
Right.
What's happening? And it makes you go, fuck, I'm so tired.
Yeah. No, that's, you know, I get you. Somebody texted me on Twitter, and they said something like, something about keeping it going, something about continuing or something. But I said, nah, I think I said what I got to say. You know.
That's what I mean. There are people that do that. But they're nameless people.
Yeah, I've never met them. So I do understand what you're saying, right?
It's like you don't know their face, you don't know their names,
right?
And they could all be the same person. It could be a smear campaign by people outside who don't want the movement to win,
right?
Who are fucking coordinating these people just to constantly shit stir. Right. We call things over here called shit staring. I don't know if you have it over there.
Yeah, definitely.
Shit staring all the time. It's just tiring. And I think where absolutely everybody that has been part of this are so emotionally drained, and we've done everything we could imagine there. We've imagined everything we can do to try and progress this. And we've done it, and we've done so much. And I think people are just exhausted now.
Right. We're
physically and mentally exhausted about, well, what else could we possibly do? And all the signs are looking good, but there's no information.
Right.
People are desperate for a bit of information just to reignite some hope.
Right.
But so, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, no,
I feel you. Like I say, I just remembered one of the reasons why I didn't text you back, sorry, is that I was about to go to sleep and my phone rang and Jeff Purdy had given me a phone call.
Oh, wow, yeah.
Only to see if I was okay. Because obviously I said to you guys, I've had enough of this. And we spoke for like 3 hours.
Yeah.
And it ended up, I had to put a phone on charge while I was talking to him. he said to me at the end, he goes, oh, I actually phoned up to see if you're all right and make sure you're okay. And he goes, it's actually been beneficial for him because we had a right old chat. It was quite funny.
Right.
We talked about everything apart from it.
Right.
And it was nice. So I appreciate that.
Yeah,
and,
no.
OJ's tried calling me earlier.
Jeff
as well,
cool.
And obviously you had messaged me, but I went to sleep straight after that, mate.
Yeah.
It was like nearly 4 a.m. I said to Jeff, I've got to go sleep.
Yeah. No, it's all good.
And he's like, no, it's not. It's like 10 at night. I'm like, no. Not here.
Yeah.
A bird started singing outside my window. But No, I just want to get on with this, don't you?
Yeah, I do too. But I don't think people are going to let us do that. That's what I'm saying. Like, all right, the where you were at yesterday, the mood you were feeling, yeah. I'm pretty sure Ramesh felt that same thing, right? I'm yeah. pretty sure maybe Fiona or, you know, countless other people have probably felt that.
Fiona, though, mate. With Fiona, she's had some health problems. And right. she's probably gone, do you know what? I need to put myself first.
Right, correct.
And so she should. Correct. And no one can blame her for that. She's done all that stuff she's done.
Right.
You know, right. She's not with her when she can't focus. And everybody's got to put themselves first. And I don't mean anyone who's listening to this. Everybody correct. Has to put their life first.
Correct, correct.
And so I don't want anyone to get ill for this.
Right. Definitely. Definitely not. Yeah. And then,
sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you, mate.
No. That's 100% perfect because I believe that. But when you, yeah. like Zach posted the other day about mental health and all of that, that's a big part of your whole entire health. You know what I'm saying? So sometimes sometimes it's definitely good to take a break, but sometimes it's also good that people don't stoke that fire, you know? Because, like, we have a common, maybe crew in all of these people's demise. You know what I'm saying? Not to shit on anybody or not to do anything like that, but I think that's my motivation is maybe if we could fucking, oh man, I don't want to say like clean the virus, we can operate better. Maybe
I think what you're trying to say is what I said in one of my videos the other day is that when this started, people from different cultures and races all had a common ideal and a common goal.
Right.
That people overlooked the culture difference, the language barriers,
right.
the race barriers, and all that stuff, and got on with it.
Right.
But now, because of the inner cliques and groups and teams and you know, inner fucking
right.
groups of people, should we say?
Right.
That now created these culture clashes and communication barriers and stuff, and it's kind of created the best thing that we had that we didn't have. We were like an international movement that worked so well together because right. no one cared about what the difference is.
Right, right.
And now there's differences.
Right,
it is. It's like we've manifested this fucking issue which was made us so good to start with because we were able to not have those issues. Does that make sense?
Right. Let me be, and I'll be honest. Also, when I was first starting in this movement, and I look at it like I was kind of like under a certain crew, but I didn't really know anything about how we operated on Twitter, you know, or anything like that. I was just going with the flow. But kind of when I grew and I kind of broke out and kind of started doing my own thing, and I met y'all guys. The movement is so much bigger, you know. It's like so many people. It's like when I think I met y'all guys around San Diego Comic-Con when y'all were doing the bus stop stuff like mm-hmm. that. And but you know, it's so much. It seems like the movement is so much bigger. But then now mm-hmm. I look at it and I kind of regret what I was doing because at that time before. It was like I was in a little box, man. You know, it's like I didn't even see y'all. You know what I mean? I didn't know Gio or I didn't, you know, and I'm talking to Gio every day. And I'm like, damn, this is a cool dude. Where was Jeff at this whole time? Or, you know, but I was in a box, man. And I think that's what people need to get out. I think people yeah. just need to go meet these people. Just go talk mm-hmm. to somebody on Twitter. Stop degrading yeah. them. Stop making them think that, you know, they're below you or they're beneath you. You'll find the movement is way better than you think, you know? So that's yeah. I think that's why I get pissed off because I think we can do so much better, man. And I think there's yeah. some people who's trying to prevent that. And I think that's just that's the most annoying part to me. Mm-hmm. There's people that's stopping our shine, you know?
There's nothing wrong with having a group of friends or being part of a team. But you need to have each team has to have individual. You have to be able to be an individual in a team, and you. It's okay. It's absolutely okay for you to say, I don't like that other team very much because they go about things different to us. However, that person in that team, I quite like.
Right.
They're a decent person. But you don't always, you know, you could be part of a team. And I'm not naming or specifying anyone in particular. But if you imagine it in football terms, right, the best football team in the world is Portsmouth, as we all know, okay, my team. We hate with a passion Southampton.
Right.
They're our rival city. Right. We hate them. The football matches, there's so many, there are thousands of police officers have to be brought in right. to keep the fan apart. We hate each other.
Right.
Because there's scummers and we're not. anyway, but I have some friends who are Southampton fans. I really do. And we take the piss. We have banter, you know, you're a scummer. And they go, your team's shit. And I know your team's shit.
Right.
But I don't not like them as my friend.
Right.
Because of that.
Right.
That's just a part of their personality that I don't gel with.
Right.
But it's okay. Mm. It's okay that they're a Southampton fan because they're actually still a decent person.
Right.
They just had judgment with their team.
Right.
Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah,
That's what can happen. And I think that's what's happened, how you described, you come out of your box.
Yeah.
Is that you looked around and spoke to people that you might never right. have normally spoken
exactly.
to.
Exactly, exactly.
God, think about this, right? I've got loads of friends in America now. Mm-hmm. I've got friends who are in Brazil. I've got friends who are in Portugal.
Right.
Sri Lanka.
Right.
Australia. What's the other one? What's the other country? It came to my head just now. All over the world.
Yeah.
People I would never, in my wildest dreams, thought I would ever have a kind of reason right. to talk to, let alone actually talk to them.
Right. Right.
You know? And it don't matter. Right. It doesn't matter if they something about them that they do that I don't like. It doesn't, or they are friends with somebody who I would not be friends with.
Right.
Because
right.
You've got to be an individual, and that's why I think it gels a bit with the artistic integrity part.
Right.
You know, you've got to let like the director to have let his vision come out or her vision.
Right.
And it's their idea, and you've got to respect it.
Right. Right.
It doesn't make that. See, do you know what I'm saying? It doesn't mean the crew that they work with are as good or bad.
Yeah, 100%.
I just want to have a fucking easier life, mate. It shouldn't be this hard.
Hey, bro. I know, man. I feel the same way. And I can always bring it to my own personal experience. When I was, like I say, when I started, I guess what we're doing is we're looking for solutions right now for people who wonder why we're... I'm going to call this the weekly wrap-up because we probably done put in enough work this week for a whole week. So this is going to be the weekly wrap-up.
I thought we were doing the old Watchmen fucking alien chat tonight.
Yeah, but we're already on 30 minutes.
we can change subject in a minute because we've said everything, haven't we?
Yeah, we definitely have. So that was...
Alien talk's more fun anyway.
Let's do it. Let's do it. 25 minutes in, we finally get to what we started for. Aliens.
Sorry. You shouldn't have asked, how am I?
It's funny. I had to. After yesterday, I knew something was up with you. I just didn't know what it was.
It is what it is. I'm all right now, though. Back to normal.
All right. Aliens. So what gets you so excited about aliens?
I just think it's really interesting that people, what episode is this, isn't it?
This is Go Deep episode 162.
Oh, God. You never said at the beginning of that thing.
Yeah, you just went straight in, man.
Sorry, man. Sorry. I took over. Sorry. The real show. 162. Wow. God, it's gone up quick, isn't it, them numbers?
Yeah, it is. I got my own computer, and now I can do it myself, you know?
Yeah, that's good, isn't it? I've noticed that.
Hell yeah. Hell yeah.
It's good. I must, before we get on the subject, you sent me a link, didn't you, for getting videos off the line?
Oh, yeah.
Good, yeah, cool. I always watch different videos and think, oh, that was a good idea. I might try that. Oh, I'll try that. It's quite interesting, isn't it, learning how to edit videos differently.
Oh, yeah.
Copying. I got, that's what I'm going to do for you. I've downloaded. So I bought some graphic. I bought a license, a lifetime license, to some graphic design app, and I can create. You know, I created that logo animation.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Company, I can do a YouTube one for you.
All right.
You can overlap it so that it comes across your screen and stuff with, like, you know, subscribe and all that stuff.
Oh, right. Cool.
I was playing around with it earlier, and I thought maybe you'd be more beneficial to have that.
You know, I only use iMovie, right? I don't have Final.
Yeah, me too. Oh, me right. too. But these other apps, if you save them to your computer,
mm-hmm.
and then when you import files into iMovie, it all works. All
right. I'll do it.
So then you can bring it in and mess around. All iMovie is the program to help you manipulate files,
right,
isn't it?
Right.
Yeah, anyway, so aliens.
Aliens. Yep, 2020.
2020. I think the reason it interests me is because people live in their own bubble, like the real reality of you're born, you go to school, you work, you die, and in the meantime, you might have a couple of holidays. You might have children,
right.
So you can start the cycle again, and you're told what to learn. Learning is this is what we think it is now.
Right,
that's what it is.
Right,
and then people don't think outside the box.
Right,
a lot of people don't look around, and that's where like art comes in, isn't it? When people start venturing and reading and looking and becoming more interested in the surroundings.
Right,
and I think. The world has, everyone's been lied to for so long, and I think we're at a time, an era now where, with the internet and the fact that me and you can communicate 5,000 miles apart,
yep.
you know, people are now starting to wake up.
Right.
An awakening right. happening.
Right.
And I shared a video on Facebook with you earlier today, I think it was today, about all the UFO sightings this year.
Yep.
221 or something so far, all around the world on video.
Mm.
You know, even the mainstream media, you know, the US declassified the UFO sighting with the fighter pilots.
Right.
But why have people not got excited about that?
It seemed like it's so much other shit going on. Story
and people have just mugged it off.
Seemed like it's so much other shit going on. I don't know.
Yeah, I know, but.
And you know, it seems like it's the perfect time to slip in that story, you know?
Yeah.
When nobody's really paying attention. Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Yeah. Makes you wonder why we're all indoors.
Yeah, I mean, I thought of that. Forever I always thought something was going to happen in 2020 just because, remember there used to be a show called 2020? This is 2020. Like, well, in America, there was a show. Like,
yeah, it probably went on over here.
Yeah, yeah. Like in the 80s and 90s, I think. And it was like, you know, like NBC Nightly News or something like that. But,
yeah.
So I just grew up thinking something's going to happen in 2020. Something's going to happen in 2020. And lo and behold, they did actually admit to these UFOs declassified information, you know?
I actually think the virus. See, this is where I'm a bit conflicted with my theory, because I think I've said this before. I think we said it in one of the other parts of the Watchmen series. I have got friends. My best friend's wives, both the senior nurses at two hospitals.
Right.
And the virus is real.
Right.
Yeah, people really are, and they've said to me. I've spoke to them like. I dropped them around the house. I think Easter, I took one of their daughter an Easter egg. She's a little girl. She's like my goddaughter. So
right.
I always get an Easter egg. So I dropped off at the door and I stood by my car at the end of their garden. So we was apart. And she was like just telling me about it. And she's been a nurse for nearly 30 years. And she said she's never seen an illness quite like it. Mm. Like they don't know what to do.
Mm.
It's like literally you're in hospital. There's nothing they do for you. They just try and keep you breathing.
Mm.
You know, and she said it's fucking horrible. It's so. But then I said, like, how many? I mean, at the time, I said, oh, how many people at the moment are there? And she, and at the time, she said there's 67 people, and she kind of looked like, wow. And I, in my brain, I thought that's a lot, but that hospital probably can have about 5,000 patients.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And it's only 67. That's
and,
like...
and then you only hear it. I know there's loads of people dying. But it's the figures, they're not, the figures aren't as high They're not much higher, if not lower, than their seasonal flu.
Right, correct. It's probably lower than the seasonal flu.
Yeah, it's about, it seems to be about the way it is, the way it can spread, which is why they've done this. But I think there's an ulterior motive. They've used this as an excuse to for things that are coming. And I actually think it does come from the fucking lab. I do think it was deliberate.
Right.
Or some, I'm not saying about our governments.
Right.
I would imagine, I reckon there was an experiment in China where they thought, let's test it out in that little town.
Mm.
The WHO did officially did an incident drill, didn't they, of how they would cope with an outbreak of it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And suddenly there was an outbreak. So I think that's where
definitely.
So I think the rest of the world have taken this as an opportunity to go, right, those things we need to fucking do, and these things that are happening need that we can cover up a little bit. So what we do, we'll fucking like scare everybody to death. We'll use this as a fucking smoke screen. Because in England, right, the government have issued all doctors and hospitals guidelines that if you die, right, if you die, say I drop dead now of a heart attack,
mm-hmm.
but in my post-mortem, my blood showed that I had coronavirus.
Right.
My death certificate would say death, cause of death, coronavirus.
Right, correct.
But I'm not ill, I had a heart attack.
Right.
Yeah. How wrong, and people in this country, and that's been on the news, are starting to take legal action, saying, hang on a minute, my relative did not die of coronavirus.
Right.
They had, you know, they died in a car crash.
Right.
The fuck are you talking about? Right. Why is it saying correct? So again, it's like manipulating the figures a bit to maintain that level of, you better stay indoors.
Definitely.
So, do you want me to tell you my theory?
Yeah. Yep.
It's way out there with proper tin foil. You know, I'm wearing all the tin foil in the world on my head right now. Because it's probably my sci-fi brain thinking of a cool film. Right, do you remember that thing last week or the week before about this asteroid that's going to skim past Earth?
Yeah, I remember
it. So you got all this disclosure coming out, all these more, the intensity and reports of sightings around the world for the past year or two,
mm-hmm.
has gone up to the point where they can't hide it much longer, because
mm-hmm.
more people are starting to see it and believe it.
Correct.
I wonder, there's two levels in my theory. The asteroid is not an asteroid, it's a mothership. Mm. So they're telling everybody, if you see something big in the sky, really close, it's an asteroid.
Right.
So but more people indoors, more people not looking, less people will see.
Right.
Because it's a pre-planned visit, so we say, or because the government's clearly in contact, as we already know. I mean, it sounds like you're mad, but there was the former Canadian cabinet minister. He came out of it a few years ago and said, no, it's fact. It's been around for years. Have you ever heard of him?
No, I haven't.
Oh, mate. He is a genuine, real-life Canadian government minister.
Mm.
And when he left government, he done the disclosure thing and said, nope, we've been in contact. They live amongst us. There's multiple races.
Mm.
La, 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 la. It's top secret. We keep it from the public.
Mm-hmm.
And he's opening about it. And I've forgotten his name. I'll try and Google it whilst we're talking.
No, I believe you. I believe it.
No, anyone listening, think about it. Anyway, back to my theory. All
right.
So, more if we're indoors, we're not seeing what's happening in the sky.
Correct.
We're paying attention to what's happening out in the streets. Any large movements of machinery,
mm-hmm.
any convoys,
mm-hmm.
you know, anything like that, any military maneuvers is mm-hmm. limited to who's going to see it.
Right.
So, either the mothership was passing by, you know, and there was a, you know, some kind of like meeting occurring,
mm.
you know, pre-planned, you know, what leader to leader type thing.
Mm-hmm.
Was it Trump and since he became president? He got the United States Space Force.
Yeah, he did make a Space Force, definitely.
Yeah.
Yep.
But I think there already always has been, but because of they know they got to disclose it soon, they
right.
had to say, created this thing.
Right, I could see that.
Yeah, so it was a black ops thing, but now he's made it official.
Right, correct. Because
now there's disclosure. See the drip, 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 drip.
Right, right. The definite Black Ops and its black budget, you know, deep space mm-hmm. programs, you know, is yep. they've been doing it.
So my other part of the theory is it, the more probably likely is that the asteroid was an asteroid. However, bunny hopping on it or hiding behind it is more UFOs, that there's a pre-planned visit or a timed visit or an arranged visit.
Right.
So they're hiding with it and they're using that as a shield to then come and see us so that the general public don't notice it or question it because they were told, oh, that's that big asteroid.
Right, right.
You know?
So then, all right, so if they're going to come near Earth, they're probably going to come on Earth, right?
They're already here, aren't they?
Right, so...
This is what that government guy said. He said they've been visiting for thousands of years.
So...
They live amongst us.
All right.
Multiple races. We've got treaties with them.
Right, correct. I know about that shit. So what's the point now of making it public in 2020? You know, and then you look at all these Marvel movies, these DC superhero... All these superhero mm-hmm. movies were pretty much about alien invasions and how...
Yes.
How we can combat that, you know? And yeah. Zack Snyder will probably have shown it the best, you know?
Yeah.
So we kind of see that.
You think of Man of Steel, you are not alone. You are not alone.
Right,
you
correct. Alone. Correct.
That was drummed into us. Correct. I know it was a dramatic way of Zod's entrance.
Right.
But you could see that as a way of saying, well, that's also a message for the people watching
right.
to get you used to the idea that that could happen.
Right.
Because Zack's film was very... science backed,
right?
Wasn't it? Definitely. Wasn't unrealistic,
right? He made it like it probably exactly how it happens. You know?
I think he actually said, didn't he, that he wants to make it as if it happened in real life, which is why I think a lot of people didn't like. I say a lot of people, the people who wanted Christopher Reeve Superman, can't cope with the fact that it wasn't all smiles every 5 seconds. Because the idea was that it was set in the real world now.
Right.
Whilst using that comic story.
So let's talk about that. Man of Steel, he was an alien hanging out on Earth. Like you said, Martian Manhunter was an alien hanging out on Earth.
Yep.
Now let's talk about 2020. We got probably some aliens hanging out on Earth, but what are they doing now, making their presence known visibly in the sky? What's going on with that?
Well, you know, the whole 2020 thing, right? About 10 years ago in this country, the government, I was obviously in the police then, so I was like, you know, working for the government and you get to hear and what's going on. And everything was about 2020.
Right.
All these changes, all this restructuring, everything had to be restructured and the plan was 2020.
Right, right.
Now, and it was like 2013, 2012 when this all started.
Right.
So I remember thinking, why 2020? And I just assumed at the time, oh, it's an easy round number, isn't it? It's like the next decade.
Mm-hmm.
And it could be it. But it seems to be that everything has to be ready and in place for now.
Right. Right. And I'm still going to ask you why. In place for why? What?
I think because I thought... You know, if you're gonna go on the theory that there's been an agreement where, because some people say that you know years and years ago an agreement was made with them to say, look, we're not ready, the general public aren't ready, you know, we've got and you think of industry and oil and all that stuff and the technology, because the free energy that would fucking destroy world economies, wouldn't it?
Right.
So they probably have a drip feed to start getting us used to it, like for example. Electric cars now,
right,
and all that kind of stuff, you know,
right.
And all the Tesla inventions, they were hidden and stolen when he died, so that they could control the speed in which that comes through,
right.
And they made an agreement, like, you know, we're not ready yet. Can we drip feed it before we make the announcement, before it becomes common knowledge? And they probably. Most likely said, yeah, you're right. You're not, then your population's not ready. You know, if they are like the Watcher aliens, maybe they're the ones that, like we spoke to before, that have been around for thousands and millions of years creating this experiment. Maybe they agreed a timetable.
All you right. I could see that. I could see that. So
that's why it's 2020. And 20/20 vision means you can see clearly. Maybe it was everything's symbolic in the world.
Right.
Numbers, images, pictures. So 20/20 could be the symbolic number that they've gone to because it's clarity. It's time for some clarity, you know?
Right. The truth will be revealed. You can see.
Yeah.
All right, I get it, but I still want to know what's their point in dealing with humans.
I don't know. It could be just as simple as, I don't know, like trade. I don't know. It could be trade.
You mean like with cattle?
Well, you don't know, dear. It's similar to, like, I suppose in the olden days when we used to go on a ship and sail to another country and see what's there and meet them and make friends and make trade agreements. Maybe it's that, but on a intergalactic scale. Or you got the ones where there's different races and we've made a trade deal so that they protect us from the bad ones, but they want to be revealed. Maybe they want to reveal themselves as our old gods. Maybe, do you know what I mean?
Right, I can see that.
I don't think it's just one, it's not just one simple thing. It's a big, pre-planned, drip-fed, everything's drip-fed.
Right.
So we spoke before about the movies dropping out clues, didn't we?
Mm-hmm.
Not just the superhero movies, but like you said, since 2008, superhero films, suddenly bang, everything.
Alien invasion.
Alien. You've had the film Contact
mm-hmm.
with Amy Adams, you know?
Right.
You've had, that was a very big
Contact,
film.
Contact was Jodie Foster.
Oh, what am I thinking of then? What's Amy Adams one?
Hers was, oh, what is that? Yeah, I know what you're talking about though.
It's like the funny little symbols, but do you know what it reminded me of?
What?
When you put your cup of coffee down and your cup leaves a ring.
Yeah, it did. It kind of reminded me of Rorschach's face.
Yes, and that, yeah. Oh, what was it called?
Arrival.
Arrival, that was it. Mm-hmm. See, Arrival. Mm-hmm. They were coming, it was pre-planned.
Right.
We had the film recently shown on Netflix, Out of the Blue, Nicolas Cage, Knowing.
Right.
That was on that. That came out in 2007, I think. Again, back then.
Probably.
Oh. Yeah, and last year, you had another Men in Black film.
Mm-hmm.
Which my friend was in.
Yeah. So
I said he was so ugly they made him an alien, so you can see his face.
Tell me this: where do you fit in? Where does Will fit in the alien human talk?
What do you mean?
Alright, you know how I was saying, you know how I was saying maybe there's some people that could be like a crossbreed of...
Oh, I see, yeah.
You know what I mean?
Maybe it's our people who are more awake or more in tune to the other dimension-y stuff and this kind of subject. Because I don't think it's as black and white as people would say conspiracy theory. Aliens, slide saucer, humans. It's science. It's frequency and it's dimensional, and you know, it doesn't mean they've flown across. People are thinking about it, how we would get to the moon in a tin can mm-hmm. from A to B, but these things are different. It's not necessarily an alien. Doesn't necessarily mean they've travelled from one star to the next.
Right.
Conventionally, like we would do.
Right. You know?
Right. But I think perhaps certain people like me and you, or the growing population has evolved to the point where people are becoming more awoken. So we're already in tune to be accepting of it.
Right. I can see that. But all right, when I was going to ask you, let's say aliens do land on a planet and they put mm-hmm. down a tractor beam. Would you go up there with them? Or would you be like, nah, I'm going to just wait it out here?
I would love to, but I would want to know if they bring me back because of my children.
Oh, right.
Do you know what I mean?
So you
visit, are you going to drop me back home later? You know, are you going to also, I need to call an Uber, you know, or are you taking me and I'm not coming back? Because if that's the case, no, thank you.
Really?
Well, you want to come back, didn't you? Because
yeah,
family.
What if they say something like, this planet is about to, like some Noah shit, and we're going to need to take you to another planet and reseed a new planet. Would you go?
Only if you take my family with me. Like, well, at least, at very least, your children.
Yep.
We seed another planet, that means, I presume they may be, that means we've got to go and shag loads of other women. Doesn't sound too bad, does it?
But they might be ugly women like Attila the Hun.
Well, you got to take one for the team sometimes.
Oh, shit. So what do we got to expect for the rest of the year? Because I know you've been behind closed door meetings. And like you said, there was a lot of preparation for 2020. We've already had a fucked up 2020 so far. But we still got a half a year left, more than a half a year left.
Well, in this country, the law is in place for 2 years to keep you indoors.
Really?
Yeah.
But
when they pass the law, it's there for 2 years. But it can be, it gets reviewed every 3 weeks, what level to enforce it. And they're already starting to talk about slowly, like, easing up the restrictions. But I think that's just to keep everybody happy. Because people listened, people were scared, people listened, everyone stayed in.
Right.
Now people are restless.
Right.
Now people are going, oh, fucking, you know, I'm all right still. I still feel fine. People need to work.
Right. So nothing, no juicy stories for my podcast, huh?
What do you mean?
No breaking news. You're not gonna tell me no behind the scenes meetings about 2020.
More do I? I'm not part of it anymore. But what I'm saying is, I think that this is gonna last longer.
Damn.
Especially if you think there could be a second wave of the virus. But what is the virus? That's the other thing. Is it an alien thing? Could it be that a certain race has now landed as pre-planned and they brought a bug with them?
Oh, that'd be crazy.
You know? Inadvertently brought this virus that's a bit untreatable, and maybe that's why all the nurses and the doctors are like, this is the worst thing I've ever seen. I don't understand.
That'd be crazy.
You know, and maybe it's what it is. Maybe they're, you know, they go on about the herd immunity. Maybe we have to fucking all become a bit more immune before we get the full on interaction. You know, maybe it was an accident. But if you remember, a couple of years ago on Netflix, you had the film Bright.
Mm-hmm.
That was basically showing people that one day you could have aliens here.
Yep.
And we'd all live amongst each other.
Oh, chilling. Hanging out.
District 8 was another one, isn't it?
Yep. Same with Justice League after they came out and they showed that they were here. Everybody was just hanging out with them. Hey, Will, let's take a 5-minute intermission. I'm going to call you right back. My little cousin just showed up and I want to say something to him real quick and I'll call you right back.
No worries, man.
All right.
Cheers.
Peace. All right. While we wait real quick, let's take a look real quick at the, we got the hidden cameras in the 40 Club Mansion. So let's take a look at the hidden cameras real quick.
You dirty bitch! Look what you've done to my peonies!
You can take your lovely peonies and besides, you silly queen, they're not even peonies. They're marigolds.
God, I think she's right. They are marigolds.
I may not know my flowers, but I know a bitch when I see one.
Oh. Please stand by for further details. We return you now to your regularly scheduled program.
So I guess we talk about aliens and the CIA come listen to your phone, I guess.
You know, I was just on the CIA website.
Oh, my God. I believe this
I found out whilst you went for your break or whatever it was, I found out the name of that minister. His name, didn't I tell you?
Yeah.
On Wikipedia. his name is Paul Hellyer.
I've heard of him.
Yeah, he was the defense secretary for Canada. And he says that, where is it? That he's encountered UFOs, that there's four species of aliens visiting Earth for thousands of years, most of them coming from other star systems, some living on Venus, Mars, Saturn, and they don't think we're very good for our planet. And apparently, on the 3rd of June 1967, he flew via helicopter to inaugurate the UFO landing pad in Alberta that had been created as like one of the official, you know, secret government.
Alberta, Canada?
Yeah, St. Paul, Alberta, Canada.
Whoa.
So.
Yeah.
But then I went on to the, I obviously Googled a few bits whilst waiting. If you go on the MUFON website, you've got track UFO section, there's live UFO maps of reports coming in.
Right.
You got, and there's like now, there's like someone, one just happened in Brazil, trying, and people upload their pictures.
Right.
Well, I'm going to try and find mine. But it's crazy, isn't it? It's, yeah.
So you said there was just a sighting just now while we're talking?
Yeah, all over the place. All around the world. You can go on there now and it's like live reports.
That's crazy. I just want to know for what. Like, what are they here for? What are they doing? What's the point?
I don't know. Maybe it's just transportation. Maybe if they live amongst us. Maybe they're going to a shop and they beam up and then fuck off while they're going around the other side of the world. Could just be there working, couldn't it?
Yeah, but...
Maybe it's the elite's transport.
Yeah, maybe. It could be something. It could be the elite's transport. You think something like Elysium type shit?
Yeah.
So you think they're using the virus to keep everybody inside so we don't see all this transportation and all this moving
maybe
about. Right.
It's getting us used to, I think, being, you know, maybe they're concerned that we ain't gonna like being ruled or potentially overruled by people, or maybe the disclosure will be we've not been ruled by people for a long time. And it's getting people used to the idea of staying indoors and not being as free anymore.
Right.
You know?
Right.
Like not like slaves, but like, you know how they filmed in Stargate, the film?
Yeah.
They came and pretended to be gods, didn't they? And enslaved everybody and made them build pyramids and stuff.
Right.
You know?
Right. So the rulers are back.
Could be. But according to that guy, there's four different races.
Right, I heard something where it's like... a little PlaySpot commercial.
Is that because you're porn?
Yeah, I wish that was some porn. No, it was like, I don't know, some little advertisement pop up on the... It does that every now and then, but...
Yeah.
Oh, damn, I can't remember what I was saying.
I was saying what the guy said, and you said you've seen something.
Oh, yeah, there was something where it was like 20 or 30 different alien races on the planet. And, all right, so 2020, so we say the rulers are back. Do we, as me and you, people who kind of got an urge to be aware of this type shit, do we fight these guys, or do we fall in line and be like, hey, rulers, you know, like, what are we? You know, like, Justice League, they fought them. The Avengers, they fought them. What do we do?
I think it depends on which race it is. Could it be that maybe there's maybe the disclosure is going to be from the nice ones, but letting us know that they've been here, like, guarding us, working with governments to keep us safe from those who, the ones that want to come. So maybe that knowledge that people would be terrified, knowing that there's a race of aliens that want to come and destroy the Earth.
Right.
But there's also aliens defending us. So it depends, doesn't it? You know, could it be that there's a battle coming? That's why they need to start disclosing it now. So we're all not suddenly shocked, you know.
Right. Right.
And if you think about it, all this quarantine lockdown, all the major cities are almost empty. Right. Everybody's gone home.
Right.
So if there is an attack, you know, it's not like an Independence Day, you know, in New York, there was millions of people and they're trying to last second run away.
Right.
And they all died.
You know what, but I just thought?
What? Yeah,
on the Smallville fight, when Superman fought Fiora, and he told all the people, go inside. That could be you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah. He literally said, get inside.
Right.
It's not safe out here.
Right, and then the two aliens fought in the street.
Yeah.
Hmm.
I actually, that's one of the things I thought didn't make sense. He either said it to make them feel safer, or... Well, I don't know. Or is it for the viewer? Because they still flew through buildings and crashed through, but then he didn't know then, did he?
Right.
So he probably just thought it was a bit good advice for the local people.
Right, but it still matches up to what you said. Maybe as a whole, we've been told to go inside because shit about to go down.
Because if you imagine, you know, in the film Independence Day, you know, when they fired at the cities,
right,
millions of people were there.
Right.
But if it happens now, there's not many people there.
Right.
We've all left.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And maybe it's a way to minimize the...
casualties.
If there is an attack, minimize the people that are, you know, clustered. We're more spread out now, aren't we? In our little towns and villages areas.
Right.
And you know, if they target... You know, like you say, New York's a ghost town right now.
Right.
Cool. And if they blow up New York, obviously that would be bad. Oh, shit, I just said them words on live. We're probably definitely going to get raided now. if aliens attack, say, New York, for example,
mm-hmm.
it's going to be minimal casualties because presumably in the city centre, that is less residential.
Right.
You know?
And the National Guard is already there.
Mm-hmm.
So do you think we're really preparing for alien invasion?
I don't know. I think it's more likely to be preparation to keep the population calm and controlled. Because can you imagine, like, a bit, again, he said it in Man of Steel. Perry White said it. He said to Lois, didn't he, can you imagine what the population would do if they knew someone was living out there? Do you remember that?
Yeah.
You know, there would be, you know, it would throw doubt in every religion, you know.
So let me ask you this. You remember Zach said... he had a movie that was going to be too scary. I mean, like, too much for the people. Everybody's going to be running out in the streets, blah, 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 blah.
Mm-hmm.
You think it was something like this? Something that he could just basically alien invasion, make it look real 100%, and then people really start questioning their reality?
Possibly. Maybe it's too close to home.
Yeah.
You know, you think about... you know, the future nightmare scene, you know, and what's going to happen when Darkseid's won, you know, up until when they fix it. You know, you look at Bruce looking over the scorched earth of Metropolis.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like this desert. It's all scorched, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And they even said it in BVS, like in the Bruce and Clark. And he said to Clark, didn't he? He could burn the whole place down if he wanted to.
Mm-hmm.
And now we've seen the future when he's under the influence of Darkseid. He does burn the whole place down. Yeah. Scorched the earth.
Yeah.
You know, and the point being is that the people... It says, I think it's more to do with population control, or it's a big exercise for what's to come. And to get us used to this, taking orders, to be at home, stay away from each other.
Mm.
You know? Mm. It's but the point being, the problem you got is that there's too many things happened now, this year. There's too many things happened. There's too many, I mean... People should be talking more about that official. It was on BBC News, Sky News, probably on CNN, or well, probably not CNN because it was a true story. You know, all the new major news networks.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it was like declassified video from the US military of a UFO. They literally didn't lie. They didn't say... mad pilot in the military thought it was. Right. They actually said it was.
Right, correct.
So, and it was fact. It was a factual news report.
Right.
People that should have been fucking talked about for days, they should have had people on talking about, well, what do you think about UFOs? Is there aliens?
Right.
What do we know? Like, they would normally dissect any story.
Right.
But they did just kind of, yeah, there it is, and it went.
Right.
I hardly know anyone noticed it. I know there's a big distraction.
And also, you know, with all this weed being legal, marijuana, that makes people kind of not give a fuck also, you know? So everyone just don't give a fuck right now. And plus, maybe the 5G has probably turned down our senses also, but we kind of don't give a fuck right now, you know, to be honest.
Or the 5G is to enable better global communication to coordinate
aliens,
or coordinate our response, coordinate our control over us, everything.
What if the aliens are part mechanical, and they can use the 5G technology to psychically talk to us?
And yeah, possibly.
Yeah, there's no way that, like, the governments, the president, and you know, they're not even that strong compared to what they're up against, you know?
Yeah.
So it's like they're going to put the 5G down regardless, no matter if Trump doesn't like it, no matter who likes it. The corporations are bigger than that, you know?
It's already been decided, isn't it?
Right. It's coming regardless.
Long time.
Right.
In this country, you know, there was a bit of uproar last year. The government signed it all off, China, and it's all going ahead, but no consultation.
Mm.
And now this has happened.
Right.
They've stopped talking about it, and it's just. And meanwhile, while we're in lockdown, they're installing the fucking.
Yeah.
Taps.
Yeah. They are.
So, we can talk about it, but it's already there. So right. We've already paid for it.
Right.
You see what I'm saying?
I bet they're already working on 6G. I bet you that's already being worked on.
Yeah. It's just. There's far too many stuff. There's far too much.
Yeah.
It's far too much coincidence. In, you know, the fact that they let... You know, think of the TV program Ancient Aliens. Have you seen that?
Yeah.
That's been out for like 10, 11 years now. But it seems to be, in the past 10, 15 years, it's really progressed with the amount of, you know, fucking... This subject matter being drip-fed into people's psyche.
Big time.
Mm-hmm. And you know that Paul Hellyer?
Yeah.
I googled him. That scope, you know, Snopes popped up, you know, the fact check?
Right.
Right, and when you go on the fact check, guess what it says?
What?
Confirmed.
Oh, wow, even they confirmed it?
Even Snopes.
Right, even their crazy, lame-ass confirmed it? Okay, so...
Yeah.
So, I mean, they're here. I agree, they're here.
Yeah.
But It's, I think it's more weird that nobody cares, you know?
No one's noticing.
Right.
The narrative that was created that anyone that questions it is crazy conspiracy theorist.
Right.
That has been so well done.
Right.
That a lot of people just go, UFO, oh, it's probably just a load of bollocks. Right. And they haven't paid attention.
Right.
They haven't listened to the official declassification.
Right.
Military UFOs.
Right. Right.
That's pretty fucking credible, isn't it?
Right. Right. Definitely. Definitely.
And if they've released that, what haven't they released?
Right. So let me ask you, do you think it's just going to have to take where we actually see a UFO like on Independence Day just pop out of the sky and then we're going to be like, oh, okay. Or are they just going to be doing their nefarious work no matter what, you know? Or are they just going to be doing it regardless?
Oh, to be honest with you, mate, I think this is the thing now. We've all got this technology at home. We can Photoshop. We can do this. We can do that. It's going to take a mass event, multiple locations at the exact same time, for people to believe.
Right.
You know, if one appeared over my house now and everyone in my street saw it, people in, I don't know, France may not believe us.
Right. Correct.
Oh, that could be Photoshopped.
Right.
Oh, that could be this. That could, do you know what I'm saying?
Right.
It would need to take a global, and it would need, like, literally government leaders to declare it on telly, in person, live, with the actual words coming out of their mouth, I think, for right. people to realise it's not Photoshop and it's not craziness and it's not this. So it's very difficult, isn't it?
So let me ask you some shit that I know, I mean, like, you know, Hollywood and, you know, is tied with all these alphabet agencies and all these, you know, back in the day, they just got connection with, like, military connections, right?
Yeah.
And it's huge in Hollywood. It's probably so big that, you know, the military probably pays for a lot of these movies, right? So they're most likely given this information through Hollywood for us to watch, and we get desensitized to it so we can understand pretty much what we're facing. All right.
Yep.
So, but I've never seen, maybe other than that Amy Adams movie, I've never seen, no, remember the Day the Earth Stood Still? I think that was a good alien. But for the most part, they come here and they do bad shit. You know, but maybe one or two movies, the Amy Adams movie and the Day the Earth Stood Still, they really didn't do bad shit. But what I'm trying to say is, all right, we're kind of prepared, we're ready, but I don't know if we're ready for a good alien or are we ready for a bad alien. You're saying there could be both. Zack Snyder in Justice League or Man of Steel, he showed there is multiple races of aliens. But what you said earlier about the rulers being home, it do kind of seem like we're being ruled by something. And the technology being set up around it is all like space-based technology. And then the same administration has the Space Force. And now, you know, the military helps Hollywood, but also Hollywood with like Scientology and all this other weird shit. There's some space and some demons and some like aliens type shit tied into that too. So what is it?
I'll tell you something about that. When I was over there in 2018, for the few months I was out there working, I was actually invited to the Celebrity Center for Church of Scientology in Hollywood. They wanted me to go and meet. Apparently it's the one where only people in the industry go to.
Oh, wow.
And I was asked to go there. And I did. And I did the talks and whatever, and, you know, the meetings and showing around, and was bombarded with, like, information and stuff. And they still write to me now, and they still try and phone and ask how I am. I went along with it because I was just interested, you know. I wanted to. And it's very, they're very, I found... Like, I know that sounds really, really fucking out of order, and they're probably not, but the people that work there, like the staff members, they, when they're talking to you and they're looking at you, they got like no soul in their eyes, I found. I felt they were looking through you. And they were just robotic. And I was thinking, like, it's almost like they were, I was thinking they're either brainwashed or something's not right. It didn't feel right. But equally, the stuff that they talk about and the whole idea behind.
Hey, Will?
It's based on what we're talking about.
Yeah, you just went kind of blank. What did you say?
Yeah, when the people, what both the last people heard.
You said the whole idea of what they talk about is the same.
Oh, yeah. It's basically science, fiction, religion.
Right.
They believe, basically, in, you know, what we're talking about.
Like aliens and shit.
Yeah, and what was interesting, I think it was on the news today, yesterday, that Tom Cruise is actually going to be filming in space for his next movie.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And
have you not seen that?
No, I didn't see it.
He's his own stunts, didn't he? He's taking it the next step now. He's actually going to go into space, and the film's going to be him living on a space station for real.
Wow.
Now, is that another way of showing us that it's fucking real?
Right. Right.
You know?
It definitely is. It definitely is.
And, like, you hear about these companies like SpaceX,
right,
Virgin Galactic, who are doing, like, tourism trips, right, to space. To go where?
Right.
To see what?
Right.
We're told there's nothing there.
Right. Right.
So, what's a pointless flight, isn't it?
So tell me this. Do you think maybe they just say fuck off with this planet and let it fall and they got something else going on in space?
Who?
I mean, the controllers, like Elysium type shit, you know?
I need to rewatch that film because I've not seen it for about 7 or 8
years.
Yeah,
it's like this little space station where all the rich people go and they, mm-hmm, leave all the poor people on Earth to kind of fend for themselves, you know?
I don't know, mate. I think, if you think of it on the terms that the elite are the ones that the aliens that live amongst us, they're the 1% elite people, you know, the deep state.
Mm-hmm.
There's obviously a reason for it to be here and for keep hidden and setting up the world where it is. The planet's a resource, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So we can't experiment/resource. I don't think they'd fuck off and leave us. I think it's because the planet's fine. There's still loads of stuff here, you know, much water we've got.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the environment and that. But I think, I don't know, it's very weird, but I think, like, the old Nostradamus predicted, didn't he, that we would move on and start living on other planets. We would spread out.
Mm.
So I still maintain that if they're ones living amongst us and the people that live ruling the world in secret, I reckon that they needed to breed with us to keep their population going, to keep their race.
So that would,
dying out, and needed to merge with us.
Right. That would explain why they are coming to check on us, huh?
Possibly, yeah.
Yeah. Now
maybe we're an outpost, one of many planets that they've had to breed with, in order to keep their race going.
So what do you think about the Sumerian stories, the Enki and Enlil?
Yeah. Well, they're so similar as well, aren't they?
Right. Right.
It has to be true. Like we said last time, they wrote and drew what they saw. They couldn't, like, make it up. They didn't have TV or books to be told, you know, to plant these imaginations in their head.
Right. Right.
It's black and white then, wasn't it? Machine flying with wings.
Right.
Well, not machine. They wouldn't know the word machine, would they? But object flying, lands, God comes out of it. How else, right, are they going to describe that?
So wasn't it like a battle with one brother wanted to use the people as slaves and the other brother wanted to procreate with the people or something like that? It's something weird like that, but I think
it's so many. I think you went on one of your earlier videos on this. That's the video you put in, and they were talking about this, weren't they?
Yeah.
Some of the aliens, the fallen angels, the ones that were left behind,
right?
Because they broke the rules of the experiment.
Right. Correct.
They started shagging. They started fancying all the birds and giving them one, didn't they? Creating them half ones.
Right. So now the fallen angels could be the aliens. So then if the fallen angels were shagging all the women, that means the aliens were fucking all the women.
Yeah.
So if aliens were fucking all the women, then there's a race of people who's definitely half alien, half human.
Yep. And that's where you get the rhesus negative blood.
Yeah.
You know, like before, and the royal families and the elite families in the world.
So
the bloodline.
Right. They say they have the divine right to rule. They're gonna rule until God comes back.
Mm-hmm.
But is that until an alien comes back?
Well, that's what I'm saying. When people refer to divine, like in ancient terms, the God came from the sky, didn't he? It was never the God. God never came from below the ground, did he? In every tale, in mankind.
Right.
They came from the heavens.
Or the ocean. So, the sky or the ocean?
Sky. So they would see that perhaps as divine because it was, you know, that's the only way they could interpret it. You know, or maybe like the divinity or divine was because it was in the sky, but you saw them materialize and deteriorize because they went between dimensions.
All right.
So that looked like divinity, that looked like it was divine, godly, and
check this out.
Science.
Check this out. Superman came from the sky as an alien and shagged a woman. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right?
He was going to have a baby, remember?
Right. Right.
And that would be a demigod.
And that will be going against the experiment.
No, because.
You went.
Two peoples.
Hold on, say it again. You went silent.
It's CIA, by the way.
It's somebody.
Jor-El said, didn't he, that he all the DNA of the whole race is in him.
Right.
From the Codex. And right. That hopefully one day he can be the bridge between two peoples.
Right.
So.
You went quiet again.
With the human DNA. And that baby Bruce becomes a new race.
Right. Okay. Right. Correct. But in the grand scheme of things, like not just in Man of Steel, but let's say the Inki and Enlil, the Sumerian story, the aliens came down, disobeyed God, and had sex with women. But in Man of Steel, he's an alien. He came down, he had sex with a woman, but he wouldn't be considered disobeying God.
No, but it's a different story, though, isn't it?
Yeah, it could be.
It's to survive. Whereas what might have happened here isn't the same scenario, is it?
Right, okay.
It's, you know, he was sent here as a baby to save his life. He's the last to hide him here.
Right. I get it.
Otherwise, it broke the rules. You know?
You notice how you keep getting quiet, how it keep like there's a break in your talk?
Is there?
Yeah, but it hasn't happened maybe in about 5 minutes, but yeah, it keeps, every time you say a few things, it just gets real silent after a little while.
Okay, let me change.
There it go again. Hey, Will, how's it going, bro? Oh, boy. Nope, nothing.
Are you still there?
Oh, yeah, I can hear you now.
That was weird.
Yeah, no, man, I'm telling you, it's been happening.
Every time we talk about things that are not normal stuff.
Right. Something weird happens.
Yep. That was weird.
Alright, so we got this, these secret societies in life, and they hold secrets down through generations. Yep. You remember on the movie Fifth Element, the aliens came down in Egypt or wherever, and they met that yep. guy, and he held the secret until they came back?
Yeah.
Do you see what I'm getting at?
Yeah, yeah. Big time.
All right. So
are you talking? I don't know. Freemasons and.
Yeah.
I know. Same thing, isn't it? Knowledge passed down.
Right, and was the knowledge?
It's repetition. It's repetition of rituals and routines and. It's word perfect things. Okay. So yeah, it's very similar to that, isn't it?
So the movie wasn't that far off, huh?
Well, if you think of it on the same like ideal, there's ancient knowledge mm-hmm. that's kept in a secret
right,
group.
Right.
Passed down from generation to generation so that the information is forever there. And yeah, it is similar.
Let me ask you, are you worried about aliens? Are you scared of aliens?
No, not at all.
Not at all.
Why would I be?
I'm asking. I don't know. You don't ask me the questions. I ask you the questions.
I'm not scared, no. Are you? The reason being is because they would have already killed us.
Right.
We should be more scared of other countries in wars. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Would the aliens bring us all together?
Not at first. It would, like I say, it would cause... Can you imagine, right, if it was all announced, aliens, you know, fucking appeared and it was all disclosed, and they said, yeah, that was us. What you wrote about in your Bible. Yeah, that's us, what you wrote about in your Quran. And
right.
Yeah, that us. The, right. It would throw out religion and people that deeply believe in that kind of stuff. If they found out that their God was actually a physical creature, can you imagine the turmoil that would cause on so many levels, you know, people's whole lives would be ripped apart. You know, or even if they say, yeah, we're aliens, this is the first time we've been here, and you look at the Christianity, you know, God made us in his image, who the fuck are they?
Right.
You know, some people, you know, they look at the First Testament, Earth is the only planet with life, so who are they?
Right.
It puts question marks on a lot of religion, doesn't it?
Right.
So I think it causes a lot of fucking adjustments for people. And, you know, you'd probably have rioting, mass suicides. You'd have fucking people just giving up. You know, they talk about the rapture in religion, don't they?
Mm.
What if the rapture is when they take the people, like, who have become enlightened... to the next bit and leave everyone behind that didn't fucking meet the standard.
Mm.
Maybe the rapture is when people around the world are selected to move on to the next level.
Mm. But what about the people who died? Did they not move on? Did they couldn't?
No, I mean, in the event that they talk about rapture, in the Bible, it's on a one day... God will judge, and some people will be left on earth in hell,
right.
And others will be taken to heaven.
Right.
You think about that as an actual physical event, maybe that's what it would seem like.
Check this out. What if it's a spiritual event? Like, look at this. This corona shit. Some people are crying, you know, they need work, blah, 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 some, you know, whatever. But look at the people who've been mentally preparing themselves for this type of lifestyle. They're all right. You know, they're looking at people like, hey, what, you know, what's wrong? You know, why aren't you prepared? So it's like, let's say the people who prepared themselves have put themselves in heaven. The people who didn't have allowed themselves to be in hell. They're still on the same plane.
Do you mean physically or spiritually?
Spiritually. Like, look at this. Look at this. I got this computer just like magically around the right time. And I was forced kind of to get it, you know, because I didn't do a podcast in a while. Right. So then it was like, damn, now I'm stuck inside, you know, and I just sitting here with the computer that I was forced to get, you know, but the silver lining to that, it's made my content spike tremendously, you know, to a point where I even get paid to do this shit, you know? So it's like I could just sit here and create content and get paid for it. And the world has kind of created a opportunity for that to happen. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, that's kind of like heaven to me. You know, I used to say in the chat rooms, I'd be like, man, if I just didn't have to work, I could make so much more content. You know, if I just didn't have to work. I used to say that. And now I don't have to work. You know what I'm saying? So it's like the same event happened to all these earthlings, but some people found a way to make it their heaven. Some people found a way to make it their hell. But it's the same event. You know what I'm saying? I'm not witnessing anything different than what you're witnessing, you know?
No, it is, I see what you mean, but I think, like, you know, if it is a spiritual thing, it could be interdimensional. Yeah. Like, because I've noticed the last year or so, any talk of aliens and UFOs or scientists, scientists have come around now to more, and comic books and films, it's all about multiverse now.
Right, correct.
They're more into the multiverse. Scientists are talking more like Neil deGrasse Tyson.
Yep, a lot of
them. He's been on BBS.
Yep.
You know, and a really well-known physicist in the world.
Yep.
And now more about, you know, fucking...
Multiverse.
Multiverses. Yep. You know, some people saying that ghosts could be ghosts, and that could just be people who have moved over to the next dimension, which is why they're alive still, but they're a ball of energy. You know, because they can cross back and forward. So, you know, maybe heaven or the afterlife isn't death. It's just you've literally passed through into the next computer level. You've upgraded. You know, you've got past the big bad boss of life.
Right.
And you know.
No, so maybe, I agree.
Aliens is misunderstood. We're misunderstanding aliens now, and we're misnoticing the fact that it's actually more spiritual.
Right. So that's what I'm saying. Think about this. You got the old TVs, the big box wooden TV that sits on the ground.
Yep.
It can only tune into like 36 frequencies. It could never get HBO Max. You know what I'm saying? Or something like that. So then there's also a TV, a flat screen, a new smart flat screen. It can get everything, all the channels, all the digital, all the HD, all that good shit. But it's still a TV. But that TV had to go through so much growth to get this premium level of entertainment, right? Yeah. The bottom TV never grew. So it doesn't get to heaven. It just still... in hell, pretty much, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, I think the alien is more like a frequency to tell you to grow, because
it's an evolution, isn't it?
Right. Because look at this: people are always talking about, you know, America's not going to get the same until we have a revolution. A revolution. They always say that, but if we have a renaissance,
it could be the same thing. Let's say everybody gets smart. Let's say everybody start talking about their art, their music, their dance, their rhythms or whatever, and there's no more gang violence. There's just like dance battles or you know, just musical battles or whatever. Yeah. And everyone gets better poetry, literature, their blogs start getting better, their videos start getting better, their YouTubes, everything start getting better. You won't need a riot or a revolution because everybody's happy. You know, you've upgraded that TV to now everyone can watch HBO Max. You know, so yeah. Nobody's pissed off because they're the wooden TV on the ground. So basically what I'm saying is maybe that alien knows that, damn, there's still a lot of wooden TVs on Earth. We need to give these guys some kind of knowledge to turn them up so they can get HBO Max. You know what I'm saying? I think that's what we do as human, or I think the alien just keep bouncing back and forth and, you know, checking on us. And by 2020, maybe somebody's treaty ran out. Maybe now another alien gets a shot at the ant farm of human life or whatever.
Exactly. Maybe there was a peace treaty made, you know, the ones that protect us made a peace treaty with us and them. Right. And now it's time coming, and it's like the bad, you know, maybe we're in negotiations now, which is why we're all out of the way.
Damn. So,
you know?
So, all right, then there's this thing called the internet that came to human form, I mean, to the humans. And now everybody can get smart. Me and you can talk, share our experiences. We can grow. You know, the brain, every time the brain experiences something new, it grows and grows and grows. So, like this internet came and it's a technological thing, but it taught us a lot of shit as humanity.
Oh, God, yeah.
Right.
It created access to information, didn't it?
Right.
You know, anytime, any place, anywhere.
Correct. But did that internet give us a lot of information to teach us to be a better slave? You know, like, because it seems like we're focusing now, after 30 years of being on the internet, now we're wanting to be cyborgs and shit. You know, like, then we'll really be controlled by the computer, you know?
Yeah. It's reliance, isn't it? People have got reliant on technology.
Right. So was it a trap?
You think about the Terminator films, you know, is that a fucking cyborg addiction type thing?
It looks like it.
Yeah.
You know?
Was
it a trap? Did they give us this technology because, like Lex Luthor, he got the spaceship's technology, right? But he made Doomsday out of it, and Doomsday almost punched him to death. You know what I'm saying? It's like he got the tech, the corporations used the tech, and the tech could have damn near killed him, you know?
Yeah.
Is it a trap? We got the technology, we're using it. Is it gonna kill us?
But going back to like people being enlightened. Right. And, you know, you see the monks and the spiritual people, you know, in parts of the world.
Right.
You know, where they literally meditate on a mountain forever until they die.
Right.
You know, and they believe they cross over as energy and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, people on drugs, hey, man, you know, the vibe and all that stuff. And, you know, scientists have said about the frequency of music.
Right.
Can alter your brain and your feelings.
Right.
You know, so what if, you know, all this, it's all about enlightenment. That term enlightenment comes up so many times.
Mm-hmm.
When in like Freemasonry, when you join, you are accepted into the light.
Mm.
You know, you are taken from darkness into light. Mm-hmm. And light being knowledge, information, access.
Right.
Acceptance. Family. Like you are trusted, you know, and that's it. You are a brother, 100%. There's no turning back. You know, people will do anything for you at any point if they need you, if you need them to, you know, and you are now you know, awoken to the, you know, you're reborn, to say.
Right.
Into the new level of knowledge. So that is another common theme, isn't it?
Right.
You know, in Freemasonry, it's the grand architect.
Right.
Of the universe.
Right.
You know, we kind of touched on this before. So what does that mean? Is that spiritual or is it a bit of both? Is it interdimensional?
Damn. Because now we're talking more multidimensional shit, which is some more quantum physics, which we know Zack Snyder was talking about. We saw Marvel steal it, and they started talking about it.
Yeah. Because maybe you look at, like, in Marvel, you know, what's his name? Star-Lord's dad. He was a planet, wasn't he, or something?
Shit, I don't know. I didn't even watch
it. Yeah, he was a god, effectively. God, he was an energy being, and he could be anything he wanted to be. He could be a planet, he could be a person, he could be a person on a planet, and all of it was him. And they kind of touched on that, and that Star-Lord boy, you know, Chris Pratt, he's half that and half human. Yet that story arc was kind of didn't follow through with the fucking Avenger films, because he surely should have been a bit powerful, you know, meaning, but he just resorted to this useless human. But that you know, he was considered an alien, but he had God powers. So how's to say that there's a misinterpretation between higher level beings being, you know, aliens and different dimensions, and that's misinterpreted as divinity.
Right. I get that. And then you could be divine on earth by just being very enlightened.
Yeah.
Right. I get that. You know, so if you...
Some monks think that if they spend their whole life becoming fully enlightened, they get to pass over. They get to leave the body, and their spirit leaves and goes and is free.
Right. So... Yeah. It's more of a spiritual thing. So
could be.
With this technology that they're using, do you think we now can see the spirit, see the other side, see, is that really what they're looking for? Or, you know, because everything, they're really just kind of getting to, like, divination, basically. If somebody's doing their little seance or their ritual, you know, even in voodoo, they're throwing their shells on the ground, or I Ching, they throw their whatever, you know, they're all trying to read the future or whatever. But then if you get, like, these super fast D-Wave AI computers that's supposedly computing with the other side, they're basically tapping into the same shit as these seances and these rituals, you know? So now they can get there with technology, what they've been trying to get there with, like, L. Ron Hubbard and Aleister Crowley for hundreds of years. Now they can get there with technology at the flick of a switch, you know?
Yep.
So now we're at a whole new awakening of the globe, because what only a certain few elite used to do, and used to have these spiritual seances and all this shit, now, if you got a few million dollars, you can get this D-Wave computer in a corporation, and, you know, you can get that divination at the flick of a switch.
Yep.
So we're at a whole different level of humanity. I don't think everybody understands really what we're doing, you know?
People are just seeing it as inventions and things that are designed purely to make our lives easier, but they're not. It's got a bigger picture to it.
Right. You know? So if we turn that shit on, and I guess they've already turned it on. So if we find any, I don't know, man. I'm kind of trying to see it from both sides. Like, does the 5G, is it going to help raise our frequency, or is the aliens using it to communicate with us, or what?
Well, it could be a system so that we are able to communicate ourselves and coordinate.
Through the phone?
A response of some sort. Oh, no, the internet. You know, it's total net coverage, isn't it?
Yeah.
Like Elon Musk, they launched like multiple satellites at once, didn't they, the other day?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, what's that, like a grid, like a net, a grid.
Right.
Maybe that's like a force field, or maybe that's kind of some kind of barrier to prevent this interdimensional process. You know?
Do you ever think that they're really doing shit on our side? You know, do they really give a fuck about the people? Or
I don't know, mate. If anything, they care about themselves, so they have to protect the planet, keep themselves safe. And if we're all dead, who's gonna do the work for them?
Right.
So in a way, yeah, they've got to protect the planet, haven't they?
Yeah, that's a good point. That's a good, very good point.
It's all very well, you know, not giving a shit about everybody because you're okay, but you're only okay because of other people.
Right. So let me ask you, why are you so calm when you talk about shit like this? Why is it so, like, blah, like, whatever to you?
Well, I don't know. I think it's because I've always thought these things since a teenager. And I don't believe everything I'm told to believe, because why are you telling me to believe in this? Why is that right and why is that wrong?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, something's obvious, like fire hot, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, water wet.
Right.
But I, through my life experiences, I found that not everything you're told is the truth. People will tell you a truth to suit their narrative.
Right.
So I've learned as I've got older and through my life and work and things, that the best way to find the truth or just have a best educated guess of something is to view all options, all sources, and make your own self-evaluation. And my conclusions throughout my nearly 40 years is that there has to be something more. There has to be some truth in many, 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 many myths, many, many folklore, many tales, many histories, many, you know, the early segments of every religion is virtually the same. You know, the Egyptian stuff, mm-hmm. the things that have been found. If you add it all together with your experiences and everything, and you stand back, look at the world, you become a bit of a wise old man type, you know, scenario. Mm-hmm.
Right.
I just believe that we are, although we're probably, possibly, you know, our tinfoil moments have gone high, we're probably on the cusp. Many, many things we've said is probably so close to the actual truth, we just don't realise it. Mm. We just haven't quite gelled it together to get the correct.
Right.
You know, but we know we're on the right path.
Right.
So for me, This should be being talked about more. You know? Like the whole, you know, just another drip feed, Star Trek.
Mm-hmm.
Star Trek, one of the longest running ones in Star Wars, where aliens and humans just coexist.
Mm-hmm.
That's normal.
Mm-hmm.
It's preparing us for this.
Right. Right. Definitely. You know?
And anyone who says there's no such thing, I always refer back to the 400 years ago, the world was flat.
Mm-hmm.
And if you kept going, you'd fall off.
Mm-hmm.
That was fact.
Right.
Well, that was wrong, wasn't it?
That was wrong. That was really wrong.
Yeah.
Yeah, I had a girlfriend.
So that's why I'm calm about it. There's something to... And also, I think it's linked to spiritualist stuff.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking too.
Mm. And it must be the same for you, because... It's not like I'm calm about it. I just don't think it's not scary. It is what it is.
Right. I think I've just been kind of researching it for a while, that I kind of probably desensitized myself.
Yeah.
But I don't think I'm worried about aliens either. Sometimes I think I am an alien, because I don't think I... Like a lot of people, the way they think, I don't think like that. I think the exact opposite, and I don't know why I think the exact opposite, but whatever. I don't know. So sometimes I
maybe people like me and you, who have always had this kind of urge or interest in or this ability to notice things from a young age and not just take it in, not just like believe everything you're told. Maybe that's like, we're like a mutant. Maybe we've evolved in such a way that we're able to be more open-minded and more...
See, that's what I was asking you on the last show about the mutant ex-kids and all that other shit like that. Yeah.
Maybe that's what it is. Maybe that's what it is. Maybe the people who are mutating, or maybe the people that have naturally evolved to be a bit more accepting, a bit more fucking, up to date. Maybe they're the ones throughout the whole world who get, these people say, oh, I always get abducted.
Mm.
Why me? Well, maybe it's because there's something in your DNA that is almost at the point that, you're going to start knowing, and you get clairvoyance, fortune tellers. You've always had them throughout history.
Mm-hmm.
It's a new thing, It's always been there, isn't it? And a lot of old religions, you had witches, you had medicine men, you had all these like people now.
Yeah.
And it became so commercialized that they got shunned.
Mm-hmm.
Like herbal medicines was kind of like shunned to just like, a joke.
Right.
The reality is, it's medicine.
Right. Correct.
All medicine's herbal.
Right. Right.
Some
just as synthetic copy of the real herbal. Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
Correct.
And that's to control the money.
Mm.
Isn't it?
Mm.
But people in the past seem to know more, and the talks, in every ancient myth, from the Greek mythology and all that, you think of the old Clash of the Club Titans films and that, it wasn't unheard of for monsters, gods, different type of creatures,
Mm-hmm.
What if they were aliens? What if the giants were aliens?
Mm.
What if we're the aliens? What if the giants were the original inhabitants?
Mm.
There's what I'm saying is there's a sprinkling of truth with everything we've talked about.
Right.
And it's just a case of putting them pieces of the truth puzzle together.
When the hell are we going to put the truth puzzle together?
Fuck knows. I don't think, maybe we never will. Maybe there's too many pieces for us to do. Maybe it's going to take a few more generations to...
God damn.
It's annoying. You know what? There's two things I can think of off the top of my head that I'd be really pissed off if I died before I got to know. And one, if I died before the Snyder Cut came out and I missed it, that'd piss me off. And two, not ever finding out for definite the truth about the world and the universe.
Right. Right.
Obviously, hopefully when you die, you then find out anyway. But
no, I get it. I said, no, I definitely get what you're saying. If we look at it, though, I always, like on the movie Prometheus, there was an android-type alien, and there were real aliens, and then there was a mixture between an android-type human-type mixed of some type of monster-type alien. There was multiple different aliens, but I always look at, I think we're closer to maybe the android-type alien.
I think you're confused. Are you on about the big, muscly, bold thing?
Yeah, no.
Biological. It wasn't an android. The android was just
David.
Future man's invention.
Right. It was David. David AI. And Walter.
David.
Yeah. But remember in Alien Covenant, he came and killed off the whole planet.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he dropped the black goo on the alien planet, and he killed off the whole planet. But he was kind of planning that, if you see it, because at the very first scene, he's talking to the guy who made him, and he was like, why did you make me? And the guy, telling him he needs a companion and blah, 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 blah. But he said, what's going to happen once I figure out that, I can live by myself. I don't need you anymore. And the guy basically said, yeah, that's our biggest fear. And basically the android figured out that he didn't need any type of creature, except the aliens that he was making, the evil monster type aliens. But he didn't need any biological human or anything like that. So he started killing everybody, you know?
Yeah. I've only saw it once. I need to see it again.
Yeah, yeah. It's crazy. It's wild. Mm. It's two movies, Prometheus and Alien Covenant. But I think it delves into a lot of true history, like what we were talking about, putting the pieces together. I think if we really like look at some of these movies, because in the movie Prometheus, she was looking for who made humans. So she went and found who made humans, but there was another alien like David who could, you know, go travel the stars. Right,
yeah. There was the alien, wasn't there?
Yeah.
Weird but, animal type.
Right, the monster looking. Right. But when David showed up, like, he's traveling the space also. So if he shows up, he looks like a human. He has blonde hair, blue eyes. But he's a robot. But people might see him and they're like, oh, there's some blonde-haired, blue-eyed guy just landed out of the sky. He might be a god. But he might be a robot made by humans on some distant planet that's sent out to travel the space, you know?
Yep. A bit like Valiant 4.
right. It's crazy. Mm. Like, we talk about the Greys and we talk about shit like that, but What if the Greys are just like the chimpanzees that they put in the fucking spaceships and sent them out in space, you know? What if the Greys are just like chimps? Yeah, what if they're just like chimps that they're just, hey, go check on them humans and come back.
And then if you occasionally pick one up and do a test on it and then send it back and then let us know what you did.
Right.
Maybe they're their bitches.
Maybe.
Maybe they're enslaved.
Maybe they're enslaved. Why not?
But there's definitely spiritual. It's, and I think, it's a cosmic-y spiritual thing. Yeah. For the whole galaxy, the universe, the whole universe is all connected.
All right. It sounds good. I'm going to make it to a podcast. We have reached our second hour, so you get to go to sleep now.
Yeah, man, I'm fucking really tired. It's so interesting, isn't it? But I think what we need to do is to maybe have an episode where we summarize all the points in this series and see if we come to a conclusion of some sort.
All right. Well, this is part 4 right now. Hopefully we do come to a conclusion. So.
Yeah. It'd be your own 5-story arc.
It will. Hopefully Warner Brothers pay me for it.
And they'll probably just edit it over and change the voice to somebody else.
All right, man. Well, I'll edit these two parts together and I'll try to have something out tonight or early in the morning.
Cool. All right. I'll speak to you soon. Take care,
mate.
All right,
man. Peace.
Bye, mate.
Next speaker, David Flynn, has quite an interesting background. In the early 90s, a global phenomenon was born known as the World Wide Web. Soon afterward came the birth of the granddaddy of all websites addressing prophecy, ufology, and Mars as well. The website, the Watcher website, completely anonymous, the mysterious Watcher regularly supplied the public with well-researched and provocative analysis. And today we have the privilege of having the Watcher himself with us, Mr. David Flynn. David has recently published the findings of his research in a book, Sidonia, The Secret Chronicles of Mars. David's research demonstrates that the ancient world viewed mathematics and astronomy as conveying spiritual relationships. These spiritual relationships were codified and passed from generation to generation in the midst of the secret mystery schools. To us today, math may seem to be a dead thing, full of boring equations, and myths appear to be just quaint or curious stories, but to the ancients, the numbers and the equations were full of meaning, and the myths provided the key to understanding. David Flynn has developed the expertise in understanding the mathematical meanings in the architecture and astronomy of ancient structures on Earth built by cultures and religions all over the globe that appear to correspond with structures on Mars discovered by Richard Hoagland. Through his meticulous research, David has discovered correspondences between the beliefs of widely diverse cultures and religions, all apparently focused on the planet Mars. If what David has learned from his study of history proves to be accurate, then we may realize that what we're learning in America today about the importance of Mars is not new. Rather, we're just beginning to rediscover what many ancient cultures already knew thousands of years before us. Within the Christian community, Dave is acknowledged as the expert on Sidonia Mars anomalies and their correspondence to occult mythology and processional phenomenon. Dave's focus will be the correspondence of Sidonia geometry to terrestrial geometry of megalithic structures and the ancient belief systems. His argument will be that the correspondences are too precise and too numerous to be coincidental. It's my pleasure at this time to welcome researcher and author David Flynn, and he'll be speaking on his topic, The Mars-Earth Connection, Sidonia in Ancient Science and Mythology. Let's welcome David Flynn.
Thanks a lot, Cheryl. Well, really have to hand it to you. Mr. Hoagland, you've really set me up so that I can paint a picture here that people will see more clearly, because I wouldn't be looking at any of these things if it hadn't been for what you've brought to light. I wonder, when I look at the Mars-Earth connection, if there's any way we can reconcile what's there with our scientific paradigms, our empiricism, the mindset that we have today that we all take for granted as being standard. We codify everything by scientific observation. When we look at the ancients and their belief systems, we often see, and it's often presented as an antiquated striving at trying to understand something that we fully comprehend with scientific methods. And I believe that if we look at what's on Sidonia, going back far enough, looking at some ancient philosophies, we may even find that what we thought these ancients were saying really isn't what they were saying. They may have been talking about a body of knowledge that we haven't even touched on. We may have hamstrung ourselves because we're stuck in our modern paradigm. And some of the greatest thinkers who actually looked at the heavens and actually believed that these planets around the Earth communicated in some way to the Earth and to the inhabitants of the Earth. These were the Neopythagoreans and the Neoplatonists of the 4th century AD. These men had access to the Alexandria Library, and at that time the library had existed for 600 years. And the only library I can think of maybe that existed in our time, 600 years maybe, is the Vatican, which is in Rome, a place founded by mythical sons of Mars. But these Neopythagoreans and Neoplatonists, people like Empedocles and Porphyry and Ammonius Saccas, wonderful names, these people actually looked at the heaven-earth relationships. And they had a maxim, and that was, as above, so below. They quantified everything by this idea that the heavens had imparted knowledge in a complete and whole gift to mankind at the very beginning. This included civilization knowledge, this included the knowledge of the heavens themselves, and this included the nature of the gods that imparted this knowledge. And if I was to go back to that time and espouse our scientific achievements of today and show them a picture like this, they would be impressed with, I think, a couple of things. Number one, that there's some features on this planet Mars that seem to have geometry on them and seem to have repeating geometry. And they wouldn't be surprised at all, because their maxim, of course, is as above, so below, the idea that the heavens impart knowledge to the earth. Plato had talked about emanation, the idea that the higher forms of existence always emanate lower underneath them to the lower forms. And so what would make sense then to them would be to see a face like the face on Mars, because humanity seems to be so predominant on the Earth. But the thing I want to draw your attention to, I think is that's the key to understanding this in this ancient form of thought, is this feature right here, which is the D&M pyramid, and this is a frame that came from Viking 1. In 1976, 35A72, but this is a more recent version of it. Note the incredible symmetry of the whole thing. It's oriented virtually north-south with the center axis here, and this interesting sort of oblong point would suggest that it may have even been a full pentagram. It's not a perfect pentagram or pentagon, but it does have five sides to it, two long and three shorter. And this was the most sacred symbol of the Pythagorean school. The Neopythagoreans incorporated both works of Plato, and they had availed themselves also of a translation of the Old Testament into Greek by the Ptolemies. They took all these things together, and they were able to sublimely pull down the forces from above. At least the fragments that we have of their history says this. And they would say, if you want to understand what's going on with that shape, you would have to look back on Earth, and you'd have to look back in its Earth's greatest antiquity. And here's a picture of the ceiling of the burial chamber of Thutmose III. And it goes back during his reign, 1479 BC, Valley of the Kings. This motif's repeated over and over again. It seems to always have the same sort of feature, almost an anthropomorphic feature, a torso and two arms outstretched and two legs and a head. So this anthropomorphic feature leads us to believe that maybe there is a point to it, maybe there is a connection between it, stars, and men. The Egyptians really knew what they were talking about then, because they connected this to two major concepts. Well, the first one is illustrated here by the Elephantine calendar. It was found on the Elephantine Islands on the Nile. It has a list of offerings to the gods on the day the Sirius rises, just before the sun, its helical rising, which is the day they started their new year in Egypt. And you can see in the circle a strange starfish-shaped five-pointed star, which represents Sirius itself. So this connects the idea that the Egyptians believed this symbol was connected to a prominent star in the northern hemisphere. In fact, Sirius is the brightest star in the northern hemisphere. The Dorus Siculus was a Greek and studied extensively the religion of Egypt. Their trinity of Isis, Osiris, and Horus was seen to form the core of their pantheon. He goes on record in his library history, this massive, massive compilation of books that he wrote over many years on the history of the whole world as he knew it. And he says that Isis claims in a stele that he saw in Arabia that she was the one who rises in the star that is in the constellation of the dog. So we look at the constellation of the dog, and it's the constellation that holds the star Sirius. In Latin, it's called Canicula. In Greek, it's Kuna Astro. That name, canine, is kind of odd. I've always wondered why this would be the dog star, and it goes back as far as you can actually research, that it's always considered the dog stars. The Sumerians called it the barker. And in Semitic texts, it was also called the dog star. And there's a good reason for it. It's an etymological connection. It's a metaphor. It's something that connects it to who it was who knew about this star, who used this star, and who connected it to this heaven-earth relationship, this heavenly knowledge relationship. Because canine comes from Canaan. The Canaanites were the first merchants. They were the first navigators. You can't be a merchant unless you actually have a ship to travel with. And if you're in the Mediterranean, you have to be able to travel along the coastline to get your goods here and there. According to Strabo, the geographer, who was a contemporary with Diodorus Siculus, about 100 AD, he says that the Canaanites had invented the making of glass, the invention of astronomy, and also the idea that knowledge had come from the heavens intact, from some entity. You can also see this strange dotted line I put here, which connects the myth of Isis and Osiris with Canaan. Byblos is the city that Osiris's body floated to after his evil twin brother Seth killed him and put him in a casket, in a box, and set him afloat in the Nile. And you can see that these contours here, Genesis 10:19 talk about what the boundaries of Canaan were. And in the Samaritan text, it actually talks about how the boundaries of Canaan actually extended to the Euphrates River and to the Nile. So I have two different versions here. But it was massively extensive, and it was connected to Egypt. Ovid talks about how there's a commonality between some of the genealogical records of the Canaanites and also the first Egyptians. But the one most important point about Canaan is this mountain, Mount Hermon. Mount Hermon is the highest point in the Middle East. It's 9,200 feet high. It borders now three different countries, but there's an immense history and myth behind this mountain in the Middle East. And that's because the legend has it that the first angels came to the earth, or the first extraterrestrial beings came to the earth from this point. And it was from this point that they propagated themselves and their knowledge into the earth. And this is in the land of Canaan. In the pseudepigraphic Book of Enoch, a book that was written before the Common Era, there's an enhancement of the text in Genesis 6 that talks about the flood. And the flood epic is interesting because it diverges from just focusing on men on earth to this idea that there's sons of gods who looked down from heaven and saw daughters of Adam and thought that they were fair and took wives from anyone that they chose. And it says, in addition to that, they actually bore offspring. And the words that they use for that in the Hebrew text is Nephilim, which means the fallen ones. Nephal just means to fall, and the I-M end on the end of it is a masculine plural, so it just means fallen ones. And the strange thing about that is this extra biblical text talks about it in more detail, and it pinpoints Mount Hermon as the actual place that this took place. The angels, the sons of heaven, saw these women and desired them, and there were all 200 of them, and they came down on Mount Ardis, which is the summit of Mount Hermon. And of course, here's a nice picture of the flood by Albert Dürer. And many people think that the flood was a worldwide event. Some people think it's localized. However, most theologians agree that there really was a catastrophe sometime. As far as where they place it in history, it is debated hotly at times. I'll get to that point a little later, but the idea here is that there were some survivors of that flood that were focused on by the supreme deity, by God of the Old Testament, Noah and his family, and he deposited them on Mount Ararat in an ark after the whole thing was said and done. And getting back to this Cain point, there's a strange malfeasance that occurred after the flood, and Noah had parked his ark, and he got drunk on some of his own wine and lay naked in his tent. And Ham, his youngest son, came in and saw him naked. And instead of covering him, he went out and reported this to the rest of his brothers, that his father, this sublime biblical patriarch, was lying naked in his tent. So you don't do that to a biblical patriarch who's an oracle for God himself. So the other two brothers went and covered him up. When Noah came around, he was in a real bad mood and said, "Cursed are you, Ham." He actually cursed his younger son, Canaan, because he had already blessed Ham. He had already told Ham, you know, in this earlier sort of paradigm of the biblical patriarchs, once you give a blessing, you've given it. So the only curse that he could hand out was to his son, Canaan. He said, "Cursed are you, Canaan, slave of slaves shall be to your brothers." And the actual name Canaan means subservient or low or lowly, in the same sort of manner you would characterize a dog. Now here's where things get really interesting. There's where Mount Ararat is. So if we're going to get to Canaan, we're going to have to travel quite a bit. And right at the edge of the Mediterranean is pretty much where you can move to the west, is as far as you can go. And the first city, according to Strabo, that was built in antiquity was the city Sidon. Sidon just happens to be the first son of Canaan. So Sidon was a son of Canaan, or he was a son of a dog, if you want to look at it in that metaphorical way. In fact, all the inhabitants of Sidonia, or Canaan, call themselves Sidonians because that was their founding city, just like the Romans called themselves from their founding city. Or they would call themselves sons of the dog. And it's interesting, this statement by a chronicler called Nonnus in his Dionysica, he talks about the people of Sidonia, and he's talking about them in his age, the Greek, the Hellenistic age, and he says, from the beginning of time, people lived here, a people of divine progeny. Their age is that of the universe. There's a lot of interesting things that come from Sidonia, and the most amazing part of it is the idea that this name, Sidonia, turns up in all these ancient myths. And all these ancient myths of foundation of knowledge and the foundation of a religious system that came intact from heaven, it invariably leads to this idea that Mars has something to do with it. This is a picture of a Sidonian princess named Europa. The name Europe is a Sidonian name. In myth, she was abducted from the coast of Sidonia by Zeus in the form of a bull. He was greatly enamored with her and spirited her off to Crete, where he had his way. This is the coast of Lebanon, where Sidonia is, and you can see the city of Sidon at the top, next to Mount Hermon. Here's an Arabic picture of the actual coastal city. And like Richard had pointed out earlier, here's Sidonia on Crete. The name Crete itself actually means great, powerful goddess. And they established a city, Sidonia, in nearly the same configuration that you see on the coast of Lebanon and the coast of ancient Sidonia. It's alternately called Sidonia and also Canaan, depending on who was ruling at the time. When it was Byzantine, it was Cania, and before that, it was called Sidonia. And this is an earlier map and close-up. What's really interesting about this area is that Europa apparently was left there by Zeus, and so she had to find some other benefactor, and so she was married off to an indigenous resident named Asteres, and his name means stars. So she literally became the queen of stars. And they minted coins in Sidonia, Crete. Most people would think that this was a coin minted in Rome. But you can see underneath the name Chidon, it's a corruption of the word Sidon. Kappa, old form of iota, delta, omega, nu, Chidon. And this, of course, is a coin from Rome. Instead of just one person being suckled by this dog, you have two, Romulus and Remus. And I think it's uncanny that this idea that Sidonia and Rome would be connected in this strange way. But what I think is happening is a metaphor, because what's being said here is these sons of the Canaanites were suckled on the knowledge from heaven. They're suckled on the idea that knowledge had come down from a certain place, a certain point of real estate on this planet, and they benefited from it. And it propagated from one place to another. And in this case, it propagated to the west from the coast of Sidonia. There's a picture of the Greek legendary hero Cadmus. Cadmus was a Sidonian prince. He was sent by his father Agenor, the Sidonian king, to go find his sister after she'd been abducted by Zeus. He was supposed to find Europa, and he searched for many years, but he never did end up ever finding her. And eventually he went and talked to the oracle at Delphi, and the oracle told him that he might as well just give up on his quest, that it was destiny, that his sister was lost forever, and that he should finally fulfill his destiny of founding a city. But in the process of trying to found Thebes, his men were eaten by a dragon that was supposedly the son of Ares, the son of Mars. This dragon ate every one of his men until he himself had to come and dispatch it, which he does here. And he does a strange thing. After he kills this dragon, he pulls its teeth and sows them. And from the ground come these men, these earthborn men, and in Greek that's Sparta, these earthborn men sprung up, and they're very warlike, having been sown from the teeth of a dragon that was a son of Mars, and they all turned on him, so he threw a rock and deflected all their wrath towards each other until there's only a couple left. But they became, in myth, the actual progenitors of Thebes. Camus didn't just find Thebes, he also, in myth, did hand the Greek alphabet to them. In fact, it was a literal trade-off of the Phoenician script. But to be politically correct, I can't call it Phoenician anymore, because that's what the Greeks called the Sidonians. Phoenician just means red. there would be no self-respecting Phoenician who would call himself a Phoenician. He'd call himself a Sidonian. So the script that you're looking at is Sidonian, and it's just adjusted slightly. And in fact, what we're writing with right now, and what we read right now, has a Sidonian origin. You can say that if you pick up the telephone or you're hooked on phonics, you're really hooked on Sidonia. In addition, Cadmus didn't just give an alphabet to the Greeks or find a city. He actually gave a knowledge base, a religious paradigm to the Greeks. And the one object in antiquity that defines this idea greatest is the emerald tablets of Thoth or Hermes. This is a tablet that supposedly was a legend for many hundreds of years, but actually exists enough that we can find facsimiles that were copied by Albert Magnus and Isaac Newton. And according to Albert Magnus, this was an ancient text written in Phoenician or Sidonian, and it was found by Alexander the Great. It's one page of 14 utterances that no alchemist should be without, that no hermeticist or occultist should be without. And what's interesting about it is, in an obscure way, it sort of emulates the Lord's Prayer, this idea that heaven will come to earth. This is the translation by Isaac Newton himself. And the first part of it, this is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. It's kind of an interesting statement because I hear that it's used quite often in court. And it'll show you maybe the origins of some of our systems that we have in place that we never have really looked at critically. The second part, as below, so above, as above, so below, is the salient quintessential maxim of the occultist, the illuminated, those who believe that knowledge was given to the earth intact. This idea that knowledge was never invented by men, gnosis was given to men by the gods. Amazingly, that concept isn't against the biblical paradigm. The ancient Hebrews recorded that there was an intervention by alien beings at a certain point in their history. And in fact, they say that the fall of mankind was under the influence, was directly due to the influence of an alien being who was in the Garden of Eden, metaphorically in the shape of a snake. Albert Magnus tries to tackle the first utterance of the Emerald Tablets of Thoth, and he talks about it as something that can be literally understood. He says, the power of all things below originate in the stars and constellations of the heavens, and all these powers are poured down into all things below by the first circle of the constellation. So the constellations surround our Earth in a sphere. So if we're talking about a circle, he's talking about the ecliptic. And if he's talking about the ecliptic, where we sight our sun as it seems to go around our Earth, he's talking about the zodiac. And this is right along with where the occult would look. And this is exactly what, theurgistically, what the early Neoplatonists and Neopythagoreans would be looking at. As above, so below, there's a literal way to do this. And he says, somehow, the zodiac is mirrored on the Earth. The Greeks can get into a little bit more detail on how this might be accomplished. They had a myth that Atlas, one of the Titans, had been holding the pillars of heaven and earth at a certain place on the earth, so that it was connected there. In the Odyssey, Homer's written, Atlas the magician knows the depths of all the seas, and he, no other, guards the tall pillars that keep the sky and earth apart. Well, it's interesting that you can actually find a place that has Atlas mountains on our planet, and though it's not a giant standing there with pillars, the Greeks even have an explanation for why it's mountains now instead of a giant. Perseus apparently lopped off the head of Medusa and then had to travel by way of where Atlas was standing. And Atlas at that time was pretty paranoid, so he wouldn't let him go past. So he didn't want to, but he had to, and he pulled the Gorgon's head out and turned Atlas to stone. And after that, the mountain was called Atlas. And this is just a Greek fragment. You'll notice that blue line is the prime meridian of our Earth. It just happens to go right over where the pillars would actually be held by Atlas. In fact, this is the position that Atlas would probably be in. He'd be holding two pillars, one representing heaven and one representing Earth. And lo and behold, if you look at the astrological glyphs for the 12 signs of the zodiac, actually there is one that represents pillars. And that is Castor and Pollux, the Gemini, the twins. It's very interesting because if you look at where they're oriented in space around the Earth and along the ecliptic, they're directly above Sirius, the anchoring point according to the earliest navigators, according to the Greek historians. you can draw a perfect line through the center of Gemini and it'll go right through Sirius. So correctly then, the Greeks and the Emerald Tablets of Thoth are trying to say that heaven and earth were aligned in some way, and this is the way it was aligned. The prime meridian is right along the Atlas Mountains, and if you align the heavens to it, and metaphorically, you're aligning the heavens so that they're fixed on the earth, even though the earth's revolving continuously. This is an idea of literally putting the heavens on the earth, but it's a lot more profound than just a metaphor. As you can see, there's Gemini hovering over the top of the prime meridian. And this is what the heaven-earth mirror would look like, with Sirius as the prime meridian, and the rest of the 12 signs of the zodiac arrayed along the north-south lines of longitude. This is a map from Claudius Ptolemy of the 1st century AD. His map was used considerably up to 1,500 years after it was made. This is from a text that he drew after his work, The Almagest. And notice that this is the northern hemisphere, and he's actually drawn a prime meridian through the northern hemisphere, right through the head of the dog, right through Sirius. It's interesting, too, that he makes the prime meridian continue between the signs of Cancer and Gemini. Here's a close-up of it. He's 15 degrees off from the center of Gemini, which would be actually a correct placement if you're looking at how to put a meridian between two pillars. He also made a world map, and this world map was 15 degrees where the prime meridian is, 15 degrees from where the prime meridian was put in 1884 by the Prime Meridian Conference. Alan Chester Arthur of America actually held this thing. And they adjusted where this went. So they were using the same paradigm, the same idea. They had benefit of the same sources. This is a linear view of how heaven and earth are aligned. Interestingly, if you go to Cydonia on Mars, and you look carefully at the meridian system there, you'll notice a strange commonality. The prime meridian goes exactly through Cydonia. This star, which actually represents the heavenly connection between our Earth and heaven, is located in Cydonia, Mars, along the prime meridian there. And all this business about feminine deities of knowledge and dogs and twins, if you combine them all together, you get the founding myth of Mars, Romulus and Remus. And if you actually look at the location of where Rome is, you'll actually see that it's the footstool of Romulus and Remus. Here, Gemini is on the prime meridian. Here's Sirius. They extend 15 degrees either side of the prime meridian. And Rome's right there. And of course, there's twins in the Roman epic, the foundation myth. Here's a little placard from the prime meridian center of the Earth, the Royal Astronomy at Greenwich. It talks about it as being time, center of time and space, which it literally is. And here's where the prime meridian is located in England. Here's a Flamsteed ball in Greenwich, England. Every 1 o'clock in the afternoon, this orange ball will climb to the top of the tower and then with a cannon shot fall exactly at one, which is 1300 hours Greenwich Mean Time. This makes sense too, because you wouldn't really want to set your watch on the Thames in pitch dark at 1 o'clock in the morning. So 1 o'clock in the afternoon is the best time to do it. But it's commemorating the star Sirius. The number 13 is a very important number in history and in the occult doctrine. And this is an allusion to the idea, the word Greenwich. It's actually pronounced Greenwich, but it's more like Greenwich, and there's other people who can make that connection. And that's a great part of the myth and the occult doctrine, the illuminated doctrine, the way they understand words as actually having an effect on human mind. What is a green witch? Britain herself is an agrarian goddess of knowledge and light. So she's a green witch in certain respects. So is Ceres, and she's the goddess where we get the word cereal and cereology. And I have it on good authority from Colin Andrews that 90% of all the crop circles that occur in the world, whether they're a bona fide alien phenomenon or not, occur in England. And 90% of them occur in one province called Wiltshire, which happens to be home of the biggest megalithic sites of Europe, the Silbury Hill and the Avebury Circle and Stonehenge. Here's Demeter, another agrarian goddess. Note the attitude of her arms. She has snakes and sheaves of grain. We go back in time and we see a Minoan priestess in the same attitude with wide open eyes and an owl on her head. And this refers back to this idea of seeing things that other people can't see, having eyes like an owl that can see in the dark. And there's a snake even associated with Athena. And she stands there as a warrior goddess that sprung from Zeus's head. And then Europa. The name Europa, the Sidonian princess, actually means to have open eyes. It also has a close etymology with opus, the word for snake. And you can see in a Neolithic ivory carving of a fetish that has extremely wide eyes. And the biblical precedent for that is in Genesis 3, where all Gnostics talk about where this knowledge first came to mankind. The serpent said to the woman, "You surely will not die, for God knows that in that day you eat from it, your eyes will be open, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." And you see what she has in her hand. It's not quite an apple. We're getting back to the heaven-earth alignment. If we look at the place on earth where Sidonia exists, Taurus the bull is most dominant. And right above Sidonia are the Taurus Mountains in Turkey. The Deccan, or the lower constellation underneath Taurus, which belongs to that constellation, they're called Deccans because in Greek this means like a deck in the ship, lower layers. Orion exists. And you see the man-bull connection played out over and over again through the history. This is Theseus dispatching the Minotaur. Here's bull leaping in Minos. This commemorates both the idea of what's going on underneath heaven, and how the connection between heaven and earth actually is made, but how Zeus abducted Europa. This is Apis, a form of Osiris with the head of a bull. And Orion was Osiris in the Egyptian cosmology. So Orion necessarily is right underneath Taurus. This is Hathor, the cow-headed Isis, incorporating the same ideas. And if you look at Virgo, she's a very interesting constellation because she's always depicted in the same way in the ancient maps. She has wings, and she's holding a branch and a sheaf of grain. Here's another picture of her. And here's where she exists on the earth. She predominates America. This is a grimoire from the 1920s, and you can see Virgo standing here pointing to North America, where her divine influence reigns. And you can see our capital is wedged right between two states that actually mirror this idea of a virgin, Virginia and Maryland. In fact, Annapolis is Anna City. Anna just means promise, but Anna was also the mother of Mary in the New Testament. The interesting thing about Washington, D.C. is it's 39 degrees latitude, which is 19.5 twice. And we find a facsimile of the D&M pyramid where we propagate our war powers across the country and across the earth. And there just happens to be one on Mars, the one planet that was the center for all the ancients' beliefs where war and the thought of a god of war came from. Underneath Virgo, of course, is Corvus and Hydra, that black crow pecking at the snake. And since underneath us, we've already taken Virgo, Mexico has taken that symbol, whether or not they understand it. And in fact, the story of the Aztecs was that their war god, Huitzilopochtli, told them in 1325 to go find a new city. They lived at the time somewhere about right here, but their war god told them to go south until they saw a sign, which was the sign of an eagle with a snake in his talons. And they found it in Lake Texcoco, and they built Tenochtitlan, which means the stone that rises in the water, which is very telling because that's exactly what the Egyptians call the first time, the Zeptepi, what happened when they were given the knowledge of civilization. And they also named themselves the Sons of the Dog, the Chichimec, before they were changed to the Sons of Huitzilopochtli. And their complex of worship is on 19.47 latitude, the number that's repeated over and over again in the internal and external geometry of Sidonia Mars. Leo dominates South America. And if you were going to Cusco, Peru, you might want to check out Sacsayhuaman, which fits right along the longitude that Leo exists. Here's a woman standing in front of this geomantic array of stones so huge that you can scarcely wrap your mind around how they were put and where they were put. You can't insert a razor blade or a piece of paper between these fissures between them, even though they're all oblong and straight, you know, they're not all even. And this one rock here is around the 200-ton range. But she's standing in front of one tooth, in front of a great mouth of teeth in a gigantic puma that makes Cusco, Peru. There's other geomantic symbols that you can find. This is Ohio Serpent Mound. I picked this one because it is the heart of what Gnosticism and Hermeticism is, and the understanding of how knowledge was given to man and somehow mirrored on the earth. Because when the snake transferred this symbol of knowledge to the woman, he was a snake. He didn't have any arms. He did it by way of mouth. And there's the pitch. And interestingly, in the Renaissance, while these pictures have all been painted representing the tree and the fruit of knowledge, they all do it in the same way. It's not quite an apple. It's not quite a pear. That's because the ancients realized it was a cydonia fruit. It was a quince, which actually has a botanical name, cydonia, Pyrus cydonia. Who knew? If you cut a quince in half, you'll find it's got fivefold symmetry. And there's even a story that Hercules went to get golden apples from Atlas at the Hesperides, where he held up the heavens and the earth. And the reason for that is because there's something very interesting and important about this symmetry. If you were to cut a quince or an apple at its equator, you'll find this perfect pentagram. So likewise, if you would actually insert a pentagram into the earth so that it's touching these lines of north-south and anchor it at Sirius or the Prime Meridian, it'll touch every one of these places where its vertices touch. Longitudinally, you'll find a megalithic site. A megalithic site is a building site that doesn't fit into any historical patterns. They seem to be built before most civilizations, as we know them, before written history, yet they're the largest structures known. And one of the greatest places you can find these at 36 degrees, and that's at the vertices here. It's a very significant place because at every one of these corners we have 36 degrees between here and here. So it's a very pentagonal number. And that's Baalbek Cydonia, where you see the Baalbek megalith. This is the largest single megalith in the world. It's 72 feet long by 14 feet high. It weighs an estimated 1,700 tons. And these chaps are sitting on it to give you some scale. But what's even more astounding is, maybe half a mile away, there's what's called the Baalbek Trilithon, and where you can see three of these monsters incorporated into a foundation. These are a little bit smaller. They're around 1,400 tons each. They're about 20 feet off the ground. And you can see incumbent masonry placed over the top of it. This is later Phoenician, later Sidonian, Hellenistic, Greek, and Roman. And the Romans built their biggest temple in the world here. They chose to build it in Lebanon, in Sidonia, not in Rome. And notice these two fellows here for scale. And here's another view of it. You can see how ancient it is. You can see the contouring here. It looks like it's gone through hell. And there's all these attempts to try to build over the top of it. Contemporary historians try to say that it was all built by the Romans, but it's kind of hard to see that. But of course you can't forget the pyramids of Egypt. There has to be two stars. There was Isis and Osiris. They were a twin pair. So if you insert another star into this heaven-earth alignment and into this meridian system and anchor it at Cairo, you realize that you find all the rest of the megalithic sites on this planet. In fact, one of the vertices right here at 77 is exactly where Washington, D.C. is, exactly. The Anasazi built a line of civilization almost 200 miles long on the 108th meridian, Easter Islands on 113th, and then there's all these other megalithic sites on the islands out here in the Pacific that I wasn't even aware of, but became aware of as soon as I started looking at the longitude from based on this model. There's more to it than that. This is a talisman by a cult leader named Eliphas Levi in the 19th century, and you can see scored around this pentagram with a goat in it, the name Leviathan. Leviathan in most contemporary Christian myth is a giant dragon that lives in the sea. Some people have speculated that it's a plesiosaur, or maybe it's like the Loch Ness Monster or something. But if you ask any good rabbi, they'll tell you it means a serpent that's connected, because Levi means to be joined to, and Tan is to elongate, or means a serpent. And in fact, this occult leader actually depicted Leviathan in a symbolic and also real way. It's a snake eating its tail. Here's a Jewish postcard for a new year, and you can see the word Leviathan right underneath Leviathan. It's a fish in this case circling the earth. So they knew what it was about and they knew how to draw it correctly. Here's an Aztec version of Leviathan. As you can also call it an Ouroboros, which means tail eater in Greek. Here's a Chinese version. There's a Masonic version on a headstone in England. And this is really what Leviathan is. There's the snake's mouth, and this is its tail. And so what we have is an actual, literal, heavenly object that we can look at. A snake eating its tail, that's the largest object we can actually see, the galaxy of our own community, in stars. And actually the head and mouth of this Leviathan, this Milky Way, is the galactic central point that we're looking at. In earliest Greek myth, Poseidon was known as Oceanus, a circle of stars that circled the universe, or a waters, the source of all waters that connected to the earth and the oceans. He was later changed to Poseidon, which is kind of hard to trace the etymology, but it can come from an actual Greek sentence, from Sidon, which just means to have been from Sidon, Apocidon. So he has some affinity with this idea of the Ouroboros. And interestingly, the circled star comes back into play with the Ouroboros. Pythagoras understood what was going on with the circled star. It was a geometric equation. If you're using a 360-degree system and you realize that there's 72 degrees between each one of these points, it actually creates an equation. 360 times 72 is the number 25,920. That is one cycle in the circuit of the precession of the equinox. It's pretty close. And what the ancients knew is that because the precession of the equinoxes only moves 1 degree every 72 years, it would take several lifetimes to actually be able to read something like that. So it was a direct influence of some heavenly intervention. So because the pole is on obliquity here, it actually, as it goes around the sun, it slowly wobbles. And when it does, it takes this circuit, it draws this line with its pole so that our North Star changes over a 25,000 plus year circuit. It also happens, and there's a reason why we call it the precession of the equinoxes, that as we sight the sun along the ecliptic, every year the sun will rise just a little bit further along this line, 72 years for a degree, and 25,920 in one circuit. This is supposedly the Ring of Solomon. You can see the Ouroboros incorporated around a star with four fins on it. They represent the four points of the zodiac. And in reality, there are four points to the zodiac. There's four major stars in the 12 constellations. They correspond to four symbols, a lion, a man, a bull, and the ancient manuscripts, a eagle. And these are called the cherubic points because in the Bible they were represented as a cherubim with four different parts. So what happens then is that our years would actually align with these cherubic points so that our solstices, the four corners of our year, the solstice and the equinoxes would align with the four corners of the zodiac. And it would create a new era that would last 6,840 years. So it would actually quarter up the precession of the equinoxes. It's an explanation, although it's a mythological and metaphorical explanation for the nature of the cherubim, but they're represented in the Old Testament over and over again in this way. And right before we would actually get into a new aeon, the Greeks called it an aeon, and sometimes they'd actually represent the word aeon with a Ouroboros or a snake eating its tail, you would hit this point right before you'd actually move into Taurus and Aquarius and Scorpio and Leo. An interesting place is because we have this zodiac crossing where the Milky Way is. And it's only one time that it does that. It does it at two places on the ecliptic, though. What happens when you take the cardinal points of the year, the solstices and the equinoxes, and you align them with the cardinal points of the sky, at one point of these alignments, you can actually see the Milky Way circling the horizon of the Earth, and the sun will actually rise in its mouth. That sign occurs before every one of these aeons, these four quarters of one circuit of the precession. And I took something that was pretty easy to actually base this on. The marking between the geologic point of the Pleistocene and the Holocene, which we're living in now, a geologic mark. At the end of the Pleistocene, an incredible number of animals, flora and fauna, were destroyed from the North American and the European continents. And in fact, there's always a die-off when you geologically mark a new era. And that occurred roughly 13,000 years ago. So you'll see 13,000 years ago that we had two points where 6,480 years fit. So these are aeons, and this is what the Greeks called this dividing point, a suntilia. The suntilia is where you'd see this arrangement here during either a solstice or an equinox. It was a massively symbolic event because if you look at each of these times, it foreshadowed some strange cataclysm here. This is a destructive epoch that I believe the flood of Noah occurred in at 4,468 BC. Written history begins. If you go back 6,480 years from the end of the Pleistocene, you actually end up at glacial maximum, and then you go back another aeon, and all hominids except for Homo sapiens died out. I think this is what a lot of the mounds are supposed to be representing, only it's in a structure. The mounds have, notoriously, they're part of the megalithic system across the Earth. They've been an enigma for a long time, and they seem to always have characteristic features, and one of them is a peripheral groove that seems to be designed to hold water. And if water is a metaphor for the sea of stars that actually align around the horizon of the Earth during these times before an aeon, it would be very appropriate. And this is the Marietta mound in Georgia. This is an older version of it. And these are barrows or mounds in England, and this is the Silbury Hill. And on Mars, there's a mound. Richard Hoagland has dubbed it the Tholus. There's actually a biblical precedent for that in Exodus 20:24. It seems to have a spiral groove leading to the top of it. And in Exodus 20:24 says, "An altar of earth thou shalt make unto me in all places where I record my name. I will come unto thee and bless thee. Neither shalt thou go up by steps unto mine altar, that thy nakedness not be discovered thereon." And there's that idea of nakedness again, the thing that got Ham into trouble when he saw Noah, by extension Canaan. Interestingly enough, at the two places where the ecliptic cross the Milky Way, you have the zodiac figures also connecting. And at this most sacred place, you have Sagittarius. In fact, this is an Armenian zodiac where Sagittarius and the Ouroboros have actually been incorporated, where it's actually alluding to the idea that he points out where the mouth of the Ouroboros exists. Here's St. George killing the dragon. This is Horus, two different versions of Horus killing Seth. And you'll notice that the point of the spear is going in the head each time. And then on the right, this is Cadmus, the Sidonian prince, killing the Martian dragon. And this is Sagittarius pointing out exactly where this mouth connects with the tail, right along the ecliptic. It's the most sacred place in the heavens according to the ancients. And the most ancient depiction of Sagittarius in any ancient pantheon is this guy who has two heads, one lion and one human. In fact, there's an incredibly uncanny look here in profile to a face on Mars. And this is actually the god of Mars in Sumeria. This is Nergal. So you can see these repeating Martian motifs here. You can see Nergal himself, the god of Mars in Sumeria, aiming his arrow across at the heart of the scorpion, which is Antares, like compared to Mars. And then Poseidon, or Ouroboros. It's as if the cosmogony and the whole religious system that was incorporated in the heaven-earth bestowing of knowledge and the idea of building civilizations was pointing back to Mars continuously. This is an Egyptian symbol for the Duat, which was the entrance place for the souls of the departed to go into heaven. There was a guarded secret by the priests that this idea that there was an entranceway into the sea of stars that actually led souls from heaven and back to the earth and then in kind of a continuous cycle. And the Greeks took this idea and ran with it. They had an idea that there was Hades and that you would have to cross a river to get there, and Charon would ferry you. And you would have to pay him what was called obolos. And obolos was a form of money. But the earliest form of money the Greeks had were actually spearheads and arrowheads. This is an obolos. So they were supposed to be giving Charon obolos so that they could cross this river. and is exactly where Sagittarius points his arrow at the mouth of the Ouroboros that you can find entrance at it, because that's where the ecliptic crosses, and that's where the entrance of the connection is. There's a picture by Bosch of Chiron ferrying an unfortunate soul across the river Styx. This is a pathetic picture of the face from 1998. I remember being excited that day and coming to my computer and thinking, finally, we're going to see what's really there, and getting a strip of mud and having no idea what to do with it. And Lon Dan Rather that night was laughing, you know, it's, you know, obviously these people are kooks. I mean, who can even look at this and have any sort of interest at all at it? If they'd wait, if the mainstream media had waited till the year 2001, they would have seen this picture. This is from the Global Surveyor. And you can see unparalleled symmetry, like Richard Holden was talking about. It has dual features, though, which he's also brought into light, a humanoid and lion. And this is my attempt to resolve both those features. This is an Olmec head from La Venta. They have a notorious head dress on and kind of square features. You'll notice the eye aperture is about the same size, same thing with the mouth. Not even the nose, but the lion side is what's really incredible. You have the eye, you have an ear, you even have a cheekbone, a nose, and that hair lip that the cats have. And here's a biblical precedent. In Ezekiel 41, where the prophet is actually seeing a picture of a future temple that hasn't been built yet, he describes the interior of this thing. It had been carved with cherubim, panels of wood with cherubim carved into them. And it said there were cherubs with two faces, and they had the face of a man toward one side and the face of a young lion toward the other side. It was made throughout the whole temple. This is another statue from La Venta. And try as I might, I couldn't get another picture of this face straight on, but you can use your imagination. This is the lion face, and this is a human face. And his attitude towards heaven very strongly implies that he has some connection with it. This is a picture of the tabernacle in the wilderness of the Israelites after they left Egypt. And that's an interesting thing, because when Israel blessed his sons, he named images that they were to use for their symbols as they went out into the desert, and they would actually carry flags that represented their tribe with them. And they were arranged around their tabernacle according to their signs. And their signs actually fit, if you look into it, the zodiac signs. And the arrangement east to west of the tabernacle was that the entrance was always to the east, and the Holy of Holies was always to the west. And that's the same way with the actual temple in Jerusalem when it was finally built. But the most interesting part of this whole connection is its mirror with this face. Because if you look at the whole cycle of the zodiac, you'll notice that there's only one pure human, which is Aquarius, on the west, and one pure lion, which is Leo, on the east, which is exactly the orientation of the face and bilateral symmetry on Sidonia Mars. And you'll notice on Jerusalem also, Golgotha, where the crucifixion happened, was on the west, and where the Messiah is supposed to come in the second advent on the Mount of Olives is on the east, as the conquering lion of Judah. An interesting thing about the Temple of Jerusalem was that Solomon conscripted the help of Hiram of Tyre. And Tyre was a major city in Sidonia at the time, and I'm sure that Tyre would have called himself a Sidonian king. He was responsible for actually making most of the temple and forming most of the temple and bringing the artisans to form the temple. And you can see inside this representation of what the Temple of Solomon looked like, cherubim, which, if they're correct, they have human head, four parts of a lion, eagle wings, and a bull hind end. But it's kind of hard to tell. And here's the Holy of Holies with the Ark of the Covenant with cherubim. Cherubim were a really big deal. It demonstrates they understood the heaven chronometer. They understood how heaven worked. They knew that God was in charge of this, and they believed that every 6,480 years, there would be some changeover. And it wouldn't be just a paradigm change. It would be a physical thing that would happen to mankind. And it wasn't pretty. And this is actually from the sarcophagus of Hiram from Tyre, himself. He's actually entombed in this thing, and he's sitting on a cherubim. And using this theurgic idea of heaven is mirrored to the earth again, you can actually look at the most descriptive phrases in the Old Testament when it describes this actual entity, the greatest angel that existed. Most people think that when they talk about Lucifer, they're talking about maybe Satan as an illuminator. And the Gnostics believe that Satan, as Lucifer, was actually the God who was taking care of Adam and Eve to the point where he was teaching them their own divinity. That's the Gnostic version of Genesis 3. Christianity looks at that situation and realizes that man had everything before that interaction with this deity. There seems to be a conflict that's been going on from the very beginning of history and has played out over and over again in recapitulation over and over again with the same symbol. And they always seem to point back to Mars. And uncannily, they point to Sidonia, even in ancient history. And this passage in Ezekiel 28 talks about the king of Tyre, but then strangely leads you to looking at Lucifer. As son of man, take up a lamentation over the king of Tyre. Tell him, thus says the Lord God, you seal this sum, full of wisdom and beauty, perfect in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Well, in that scene, you know, there's only Adam and Eve, and of course, the snake. You are the anointed cherub who covers. You have walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. And after many years of looking at this, I'm pretty convinced that the stones of fire is a Hebrew metaphor for the planets. You were perfect in your ways from the day that you were created until unrighteousness is found in you. Therefore, I have destroyed you, covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire. You have profaned your sanctuaries. You know, these actually do fit the definition of sanctuaries. Sometimes we ascribe too much human ideas to the buildings or civilization ruins here, thinking that if whatever built them, they must have lived in them or needed them for shelter, but they're more a purveyor of message than anything else. I don't know if we can ascribe so much humanity to them or so many human ideals to them, because although there seems to be an incredible connection between what we see on Sidonia and what we see in ancient history and building, I think that it's more an idea of conveying higher concepts that are ethereal and very difficult to grasp in just architecture. And after this entity profaned his sanctuaries, God brought from the midst of him a fire and destroyed what was on whatever planets he was on. What's interesting, after Ezekiel 28, you have the very next passage which talks about Sidon. The next prophecy is, son of man, set your face towards Sidon and prophesy against it and say, thus says the Lord God, behold, I am against you, Sidon. I will be glorified in the midst of you, and they shall know that I am the Lord. And when I shall have executed judgments in her and shall be sanctified in her. It's almost a paradox. This is this duality, this idea that he'll destroy Sidon at the same time be sanctified and glorified in this area. If you look at the history of Sidon on earth, it really kind of went out with a fizzle. There really wasn't much to it. It was destroyed over and over again by invading armies, but you still can go to Sidon in Lebanon. There's still a city there. What I think is being alluded to here, and this is what I think the Neoplatonists and theurgists of ancient times would actually say, is metaphorically, we're looking at a paradigm of worlds. We're looking at a paradigm of entities that actually have imparted knowledge from the very beginning and continue in some way of bringing knowledge to men who are open to it, and sometimes even without their understanding. Well, once you've seen all this, you can't unsee it. So I think that the next time you watch Dan Rather talking about what's not on Mars, you'll be able to make a much more informed decision about it. Thank you very much.